Okay, welcome to the planning board meeting for Monday, August 8, 2016. I'd like to thank HCAM for recording this. We have a full house on planning board members here today, but it's always good that it is recorded for helps with potential minutes and for other public members to see it. Thank you to the school committee and the school superintendent for providing these luxurious surroundings for our meeting tonight as opposed to a normal cramped 2:11. The agenda tonight, we're going to spend just a few minutes discussing annual goals. It'll be more of an introduction tonight because I want to move on to a bunch of other stuff, but I want to get the planning board thinking about that. We have continued public hearing for the new elementary school, which will go on for a good hour and a quarter, and we have about an hour or so for continued public hearing for faulty homes on the north side of Legacy Farms. We have a lot of miscellaneous stuff to go through, and we'll try to get out of here 10:15 or so. I think it's kind of realistic tonight, unfortunately. Let's see. Let's start off with the discussion on the annual goals. I had Jennifer type out just 9 items that were, many that are lingering. Many of them are, a couple of them are kind of new ideas. And this was just to get thought started, and we'd certainly want to have additional portions to it. As I said, I'd like to get some other stuff done in this first 15 minutes, so this is kind of an introduction and a brainstorming if you want to add some, and then we'll spend some more quality time at one of our future meetings to really go through it and set them and vote the goals. Any board members wish to have something? Oh, the other thing on goals, to get these done, and 9 is probably too many, so maybe we'll pare this down, but I'm also going to want everyone to think about which one of these you're going to step up and shepherd through the process, as opposed to the staff or
number 5
or your chairman. But anyway, we'll talk about that the next time. But anyway, are there any additions to this, or any of these that you just think we ought to just not throw out just right away?
I have a question about number 9. What is the utility pole legislation? Are you looking to create one?
I'm looking to kind of create one. There was, as we mentioned in our minutes, there was a representative from Framingham that introduced some legislation that would put time limits on removal of double poles and also time limits on relocating poles, the interest that I think the town has in information. So basically, this would be to try to get in the next session of the legislature something that would do it. I have no clue on the whole process as to how to do it, but I think it's something that would be a valuable thing.
Ken, if I may,
yeah.
is it a question of getting poles removed as well?
And yes.
get burying the lines?
Well,
I think you're talking about the timeliness of it.
It's really the timeliness. I mean, you know, we moved a few poles on School Street to put in that intersection. It took them the better part of a year. You've heard us talk about Legacy. We had problems over at the 110 Grill building, you know, for a long time, you know.
Not to digress, but there's one pole up on Winter Street that is shattered, and I've brought it to Ken Weissmantel's attention. John Westerling, and then he notified Eversource? No, yeah, Eversource. And still nothing. And that pole looks like it's ready to come down.
If you did an inventory of the double poles and the half poles and whatever, you'd be surprised on how many there are in the town.
Ken, what's the gist of number 7?
Yeah. Number 7, if you look at our town bylaws, the private road bylaws and how to accept a street to make it a public way, those bylaws are so bad that between myself and Ray, we can't even understand them. It's It's a bylaw change that needs to be done.
No, thanks. That makes sense.
Just a question, downtown revitalization and parking, don't we already have a group doing that? Is that something you would join that group, or?
I think the committee is, I'm not sure, I don't think they're still working at it, but this will be the, we've had that goal for a number of years, and a lot of it, I think, will be pushing through the corridor improvement project that will be getting in earnest really quick, I think, because it's in, what was it, 2019 budget? I think it's budget, yeah, year. So there's going to be a lot of work being done on that, hearing-wise and whatever. And the parking is an issue downtown as well.
Number eight, Ken?
This is primarily the right turn onto Lumber Street.
With, in front of the Starbucks?
Yes. John?
I don't know if it adds to this or might be interesting to have, but identifying maybe 5 or 10 largest parcels available for development in town, both commercial and residential, to get a handle on if these get developed, what's the potential impact looking forward. There's a parcel for sale now that has room for 12 houses to be developed, and large houses. So it might be interesting to identify those parcels to get a handle on all of this. What's the future traffic and development that could happen if somebody developed the property?
That's kind of under six.
Yep.
And we also used to, the planning board 20-something years ago used to go out to all the major property owners and just kind of ask them what they're thinking about doing, and also going to the business owners. I think the selectmen used to do that years ago, and I don't think that's going on. And, you know, our friends with Dell EMC might need to feel a little bit of love to stay around. So,
chair recognizes.
Yeah. It's the internal.
Ken, one thing I was thinking too, and haven't brought it up yet, but the guardrails that we have around here, we have some that are wooden, which are really nice, aesthetically pleasing. We have, and the other ones that are aluminum, I assume. I don't think we, like Westboro has a bunch of them painted brown, and they're kind of more aesthetically pleasing. And if you look at Fruit Street, where they just repaired that bridge, and I go down there and I see these bright, flashy aluminum guardrails. So I don't know if maybe we could stick it with number five or something, talk about, or a separate item.
Wouldn't that continue to upkeep and maintenance and all that other stuff that has to go along with that?
Why don't we just add to the list?
Yeah, let's just add to the list.
Guardrail standards?
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. This is kind of, I'm happy of leaving this kind of right here. And it isn't to say we can't add some as you think about it more. And like I said, if there's one or two of these that you're particularly interested in, get prepared to raise your hand at the next meeting. let's try to, we got another 8 minutes before the planned hearing. Let's see. Is anyone here for Zero Pond Street?
They're not going to come, so
okay.
We can do that.
Jennifer, do you want to introduce that one?
So that's just a land swap to correct some encroachments. If you look at the plan on in front of you, it's a land court plan, and there's some encroachments along this side, including a basketball court and a driveway entrance, and land court won't sign off on the plan to correct the encroachments. So
Jennifer, I see that a lot of places. Zero. What does it mean? Like, where does that fall on?
Zero pond.
Yeah.
It has no number.
But where logically is it? Is it the very beginning?
It's kind of right across from the street that when we approved the rock wall recently.
Oh yeah, I know that house there. Yeah.
Yep.
So it's across from that.
Yeah, it's right across from that.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So it meets all the requirements of the A&R plan.
Okay.
It's pretty straightforward.
Look for a motion to sign and endorse the A&R plan.
It's actually right in through here.
So moved.
You're swapping.
Second.
Can I, excuse me, I didn't hear what you were saying. So could you just make sure that I'm privy to that?
So it's a land court plan?
Yeah.
And in order for them to correct these, the boundaries of the land court plan, there's some encroachments along here. So they have to swap that back to this guy.
Okay.
So there's like a basketball court and a driveway entrance in through here.
Yeah.
So they're swapping this piece of land over to this guy.
Just for the land court purpose?
Yep. And then they're going to come back later and do some other stuff, but right now that's all they're doing.
Are they deeding that to that person?
Yes, they're selling it to him.
Selling it to him?
Yes.
Okay.
It meets all the frontage and other requirements. We have a motion and a second to endorse the plan. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. We need two signatures and no date, I believe.
Yep.
Okay. Is there anyone here from Maspenock Woods?
Yes.
Good.
Maspenock.
Come on in. It's your lucky day.
Wow. Oh, and he has presents for us, too. Yes.
So I'm here to talk about the revision to units 29 and 30. And I have the front elevations and the floor plans blown up so that we can take a look at them. On my right is the revised plan, and on my left is the original plan. The building envelope between the rear property setbacks and in the two road sides created more of a parallelogram than a rectangle. So we were able to lay out a more attractive, larger first floor by stepping one of the units back and not having it, not having the building shaped so much like a rectangle, but more like a parallelogram. And you can see on the front elevation how the left unit is stepped back about 5 feet.
The right unit?
Yeah, the right unit.
Yeah.
I'm looking at it backwards.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
So does it go all the way back then, that 5 feet? So we're just essentially shifting that one?
Yeah, I have the floor plans that I can compare, the first floor plans, if you want to take a look at that. And I have the site plan, so you can look at it in that vision as well.
Oh, okay. We're going to have to decide two things tonight. One is whether this is considered a major change or an administrative change. And second of all, whether we're even wanting to think about entertaining the change at this point. It adds a bunch of square feet to the unit, but the part that I'm personally most concerned about is that it adds two studies to each unit. One study almost looks like a third bedroom. That's my concern.
Why don't I get the floor plans up?
Yeah.
Changes it.
If you look at the second floor, you have a, quote, study. It doesn't have a closet, but right off of that, there's a door to a storage attic area that looks to me more like a master closet than anything else. And, you know, our bylaws only allow two bedrooms in these type of units, and I can't imagine why you would need two studies.
That's actually mislabeled as a, where it says study here, that's actually supposed to be a closet. The architect mislabeled that. Is that what you're referring to?
Is that the original?
This is the...
Yeah, the original's flat.
Yeah, that's the original.
Yeah. Okay.
He's talking about the new.
Okay.
You know, you've got a storage room on the top, and you've got a huge study that looks to me more like a bedroom than anything else.
Well, the study's open to the stairs.
Mr. Chairman, isn't it roughly the same size as the original plans, though?
It's really, all the plans have a study and a bedroom upstairs.
Is the square footage basically the same?
The square footage is larger by about 300 square feet in total, 250 on the first floor and then 50 on the second floor. And what we were trying to accomplish was to create a larger first floor, which was the feedback we were getting from the market.
Okay, but these were already approved, right, Ken?
Yes.
Yes.
And then the foyer, you would call the upstairs landing a foyer?
We usually call it a loft space. The architect has it shown as a study, but it's a loft. The stairs open, walk up to this area, and all of the plans in the development have that type of space. It's hard to have, most of the plans have a first floor master bedroom, and so we only can have two bedrooms. So it's hard to create a second floor with just one room. So typically when we come up the stairs, there's a loft type space. It's labeled as a study here. People usually set up some sort of...
Yeah. So if I understood correctly, you said it's roughly 300 square feet bigger, but only 50 feet on the second floor, 250 feet on the first floor? Is that what I'm hearing?
That's right.
So can you just explain to us where most of the 250 is?
Right
now
we're looking
at
the first
floor.
Yes.
Yeah. Sure.
And then, but going back to where you're at right now, before you head off, the study, that square footage, it looks here 12.7 by 16.10.
Mr. Chairman, this feels like a major.
Yeah.
Yes. And that's on the new plan.
I'd like to make a motion.
It is.
Go ahead.
I make a motion here that this is a major change. This is not a minor change.
Yes.
I would second that.
Okay.
It is.
We're kind of at a point where we're going to be stopping based on time because we have a scheduled public hearing, but we have a motion on the floor to consider a major change, which that means that if you want to go ahead and do it, we'll come back and sit on it and discuss it.
Just to be clear, the reason it's major is because of the increase in the square footage?
Correct.
Is that what everybody's
saying? That's correct.
Okay. Yes. The increase in the total square footage?
Yes.
Is that?
Yes.
Okay. That's fine.
Okay.
So we're happy to come back and have a more detailed discussion when there's more agenda time to accomplish
that. Okay.
We're going to vote on it. Before we go, maybe you might want to think about the redesign as you have it, because like Ken says, I think I'm only surmising from what I'm hearing, it does look like another bedroom. So that's a huge study area for the second floor.
Okay. Motions on the floor. All those further discussion, seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Let's see. We will reopen the public hearing for 129 Hayden Rowe Street. This is the new elementary school building site. Site plan review application for the town of Hawkinton. And why don't we start with kind of a discussion of where we are from where we were a couple weeks ago.
Absolutely. So we've tried to streamline it, lining up with your agenda. So what I've done here is an outline that matches your agenda. In a few instances, I've juggled them because they make sense in the order in which we present them.
Okay.
But you'll note when you look at the outline posted up on the board there, I have your agenda item to the right of the bolded title of the topic that we're going to talk about.
Okay.
Where we left off last time, we covered parking lots, we covered traffic, we talked about trails. So for those three, we'll have an update. Those are the first three items. After that, we'll start with new topics that we didn't get into detail of but did dance around at the last two meetings, and that's the site lighting and EMC Park connection. Then we'll talk about the building design. We'll have a discussion on fire safety, utilities. We have an update from Conservation Commission, wetlands, and stormwater management. Buffer zone in terms of supplemental and then impacts to abutters that we've met with since our last meeting. You asked us about playgrounds, so we'll show that. We also have a graphic on snow removal zones, and then lastly, construction management plan.
Great.
So from that, we'll start with traffic. As we last met, we heard the concerns of this committee as well as your traffic engineer Beta. We also had meetings with John Westerling of the DPW, and we've met with the abutters to talk about some of their concerns as it relates to traffic on Hayden Row. We all understand that Hayden Row is a busy thoroughfare, and us introducing a new intersection with new turning lanes is a big change to the street. The project initially proposed to have a traffic light there as a way to mitigate the flow of traffic on that street and try and improve it so we could be a good contributor to the roadway issue as opposed to being hurting it. Some of the other items that were brought up and questioned by DPW was the offset of the geometry. They wanted to make sure that the northbound approach had enough space so that it was not clanking mirrors with the southbound left turn lane, so we've looked at that as well. And we've also studied the traffic light and the warrants associated with it. So as was noted at the last meeting, this is a school project that's at a dead-end driveway. It does not meet all the warrants that are needed to have a traffic light. Some engineering evaluation was done, and it could be provided as part of the project. We heard loud and clear at this forum, as well as from DPW and other people at the previous town meeting initially, that the corridor itself of Hayden Row needs some study. So where we've focused our effort on is extending the left turn lane as you approach from the center of town down to the school project and put our effort there. So we've, at the bottom of the plan, we've offset the geometry. So you'll now see a painted median strip that's 8 feet wide. So that now shifts the traffic over. So we've resolved the offset issue raised by John. The Q lane, as you come down Hayden Row from the center of the street, now taking a left onto campus, we've extended that by 100 feet. You can now fit 8 to 10 cars, depending on how closely they pull to each other's bumpers. 8 are comfortable, 10 can actually fit. At least 3 buses can fit within that turning lane as well. So the flow of buses, if you recall, there was a 6-bus loop that goes from here to Elmwood, and then Elmwood sends their buses there, and there's a reciprocal relationship as they flow. So it can handle a gang of 3 at a time, which is about the speed they'll offload them as they get them through the zone at each particular school.
What's the total length of that now? Sorry?
The total length is 150 feet.
Okay, thank you.
So that brings us to the traffic light. So we concur with the committee and other people in town that a study would be best suited. Some of the bigger problems happen at Chestnut Street, and obviously the flow of the middle school, high school driveway is significantly more than this, and so the project would get behind support an overall traffic study. What we're proposing to do at this point is not install our traffic light, but to provide the conduits underneath the roadway. So should that other study provide that this is the right location for the traffic light, we can have that installed at a future date. What we're still proposing to do is have pedestrian crosswalks there that have the blinking yellow lights, similar to what you have out in front of Town Hall, so that people leaving the school can safely get across the street with lights flashing to draw attention to the passersby that this is a pedestrian access and a main entrance to the school.
If I may?
Sure.
Go ahead.
So when you say that you'll put the conduit in and have it bid, does that mitigate the aspect of you already having an allotment for the lights and taking away from that once that study is done and that light may incur that expense, so now the town, it reverts back to the town to pick up that expense, and you put that money back into the school?
It's always the town.
That would be the correct assumption, I would think.
So there are two things. One, we're obviously extending the amount of roadway work we're doing on Hayden Row, so we are spending some of that money associated with the traffic light, but any money we don't spend is associated with that would be left in the project budget, and we have a finite budget, and if there's money left over.
But we knew that we needed proper traffic control in order to get the school into its proper place. So that would be part of the initial plan anyway, was to make sure that we had proper traffic flow. So when we presented you with the situation that the traffic line was for the left-hand turn was not quite long enough, and we sent you out with proposition to come back with us and find a way to make that look a little bit more suitable, doesn't negate the fact that there's still a possibility of the light, and even though you're spending the money to do that, that has to be paramount in order to get the school to function properly with the traffic. So
you're saying the school does not operate without a light?
No, I'm not saying, no, 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 I'm not saying any of that. I'm saying that the line, as my brethren brother had pointed out, David, was that was not in scale to what you had there. So you guys went back and made something to look better, and you did your due diligence.
Right, we've improved the plan since the draft that was submitted to you for your initial review.
Right.
Correct.
Through the chair.
Can I finish what I'm doing here?
No, excuse me, through the chair. We heard a message loud and clear 2 weeks ago. We had budget for a traffic light. We put it in. We heard loud and clear from this board and the DPW director that the traffic study doesn't warrant a light and take it out. We've put a lot of expense to take it out of all the printed plans as requested by this board. So, Mr. Chair, if you could help us explain this to the board.
I'm not sure that we gave you a firm direction one way or the other on it last time, but I do recollect that the warrant does not necessarily require it. There were several folks that spoke up on it. We gave back some action items. But to kind of cut you short a little bit, Cliff, if they don't spend the money on this, yeah, they can spend it on whatever else. And if we, as a town, decide to improve the corridor, which would be a light here or a light somewhere else, of course, yes, we're going to pay for it out of our taxes.
Okay, because
but there's no money coming back out of the project for it.
Well, what I thought, and this is my assessment, was that if it was already allocated in, and that the light was there, we're paying for it twice as a residence.
That's kind of irrelevant to our discussion.
Right.
Okay, so it's not germane.
Yeah. Okay, so basically what I am seeing, to kind of summarize this for the board, Beta looked at the left turn lane. Are you guys comfortable with what you're seeing now?
We received plans at the end of last week, and we received the analysis at 2 o'clock this afternoon.
Okay.
So we have not had sufficient time to dissect the analysis to see if the analysis supports the length of left turn provided.
Okay, so at this point that's still an open item.
Yep.
But I think
we understand it's a fluid process.
I sense that we're ongoing on that process and we're making progress on it. That's what I sense.
One quick point of clarification. Before you were relocating two utility poles, is there more since you're adding another 100 feet?
Yeah, there's a third one. We're going to get to that utility
okay.
update. But yes, there are three. That related back
That's
to
fine.
Your
Thank
initial
you.
Question about not having a new pole on campus.
Yep.
We've now had to get rid of that new pole. We had to move a third pole, so that was being moved anyway as part
okay.
of the last
Thanks.
Meeting's updates.
So basically, let's check off the traffic signal.
So, and
yeah, I just wanted to give you first.
Yeah, the abutters here. We did meet with the abutters beforehand and talk about traffic lights and impact.
Yeah. Okay. So Dave DeStefano, 134A. So the point that we talked about that I was a little unclear on was the remaining lights were going to be flashing crossing lights.
Correct.
And you talked about one being a yard arm, and I was hoping that we wouldn't have to do that. So I want to bring that up to the board, is that there's still going to be a yard arm, and certainly is one abutter and another abutter that could make the meeting work against that, as opposed to having just a standing light similar to what's at Town Hall.
Which is what
you
just said.
I don't
said.
Know if I'm not clear enough.
You just said
no, right, it is. I can point that on the board over here. What Dave's referring to is there's two approaches on Hayden Rowe Street. The one on this side is just a standing pole for a pedestrian cross, so anybody coming down will see that. But we're proposing the yard arm here because there's three lanes here, so we wanted to make sure that the signal could be seen by each of the lanes. And then since we're changing the geometry, the engineers felt that if we put just a vertical one here, you might not see it till you're late in the process. So that was why they proposed it, but he asked us to look at that, and it's something we will look at. But the yard arm is on this side, which faces both approaches, and then there is a post here catches that approach.
And these will only be actuated by somebody at the time wanting
right,
to cross the line.
The
sure.
Okay.
Yeah, I understand that. It's just
okay. As far as the yard arm, we'll take that as an action item on Beta for a recommendation. Sounds reasonable to me, but you know, you've heard everyone's concern, but we'd like to have your recommendation on that.
Through the chair, yep. We also had to talk about the hours of operation. So if it's on automated operations up until a certain time at night,
this is not a light.
This is
a light
crossing signal.
Right.
This
is just
anyone who's
across.
Okay.
Yeah.
On
push
demand.
The button. If you're walking across and jogging at
2 a.m.
2 o'clock in the morning, Have at it.
So, Mr. Chair, I just want to say that I think it's a positive thing, the changes, the extension of the left turning lane, the infrastructure for the traffic signal, and the walkway across. Thank you for doing that.
Yes.
Okay, I think we're making progress. Do we have a consensus tonight that the traffic signal itself, other than the crossing signal, is not needed? I'm seeing that.
Yes.
So let's check traffic signal off the end, but we will still look at, I'll say, the intersection itself as far as how it's looking at, you know, the geometry of it. The geometry and the type of flashing light are still an action.
And just to be clear, we will still have the crossing guard, right? The trained crossing guard?
Yes, yeah, the crossing guard moved from their function off the street down there.
And again, just to be clear, they are deputized to control traffic as well, not just cross.
They perform the same function that they do at the high school now.
Okay.
Okay. Why don't you move on to your next point, please?
Okay. So with your highlights on the yellow, does that mean whatever's not highlighted yellow is still open for discussion?
Correct.
So I believe we talked about the roadway being built to subdivision standards at the last meeting. It's built to the thicknesses of the pavement that are required. We're providing all the utilities for the future development down there. We have granite curbs and sidewalks on our side of the road and a Cape Cod berm on the side that has the swale. So I believe we've covered that in the drawings. And that
well,
should be the full update.
I think
the real question, I think, has to do with whether or not the town is going to accept this as a subdivision road in the future. Are you planning to potentially, I guess, in the future, I guess you'd have to subdivide it for us to accept that as a public way? It all has to do with Chapter 90 stuff, but you're getting, are you intending basically to provide the rest of the stuff at a future time that we're looking to do this?
I suspect what will happen is the school then won't end up with the whole ball of wax. The selectmen will subdivide the Irvine property, and the subdivision will probably be somewhere along the tote road, the entrance road. Our intent was all along, the guidance we've given the architects, the engineers, was build a road so it doesn't end up like the loop road. And you can remember the loop road argument from the 27 town meetings. We don't have that same argument here. So it's being built to the standards that you guys require. The John Westling requires in terms of the standards for the thickness and the subgrade. And we actually went to great expense and guides with John Westling and putting in the appropriate amount of sewer, water, electric conduit, and all that stuff, thinking that it's going to be used for something else someday. So we did plan all for that.
Okay. So
whether the selectmen ever accept this road or not is clearly in their hands.
Well, it's a town meeting.
Town meeting.
Right. With them and our recommendation, but whatever. And I think just to clarify that, for subdivision standards, then we would need a plan that we would need, in, you know, bounds and all that good stuff.
The as-built plan is?
As-built plans, which is the kind of a little loop road type thing, and, you know, but.
Well, you're shaking your head no, or is that?
We have no plan.
Right.
Our job is to build a school. What the selectmen do with the rest of the land is clearly theirs and town meeting. All I wanted to do is give you a road you wouldn't have to fix in 6 years.
Right. Gotcha. Good. Okay, let's consider that one closed.
So the last meeting we talked about parking lot configuration. We showed you the pickup drop-off of both the parents and the buses. We talked about the number of spaces and the geometry of those parking lots.
Chair,
was an action item.
If I may.
Let him finish.
I understand, but we're going over something that has been checked off, I don't want it to pass by.
Which is what?
The sidewalks. The pervious sidewalks that were mentioned.
We'll talk to that later. That's not this. The sidewalk in here is the sidewalk out on Hayden Rowe. That was checked off.
Okay.
The other one we'll get to.
All right.
Please continue.
So the action item at the last meeting was the interpretation of the 10% of landscaping. It was sent to the zoning board as a zoning enforcement officer. I always get that. So the zoning enforcement officer, we presented the plan, we presented our argument. This is the plan that you see before you, as we've defined the parking lot interior as inside those red bubble loops there. So that's the front parking lot there, where we determined that it was 18% of the parking lot interior had landscaping, because we defined it as what separates the loop road from the actual parking lot. And he had a determination that came back that said that we comply through that he found that the compliance with this factor was unreasonable based on the Dover Amendment, is the wording of the memo that came back.
What I read out of that is, sorry to the chair, but he's saying it doesn't comply. Is that what?
Saying it doesn't
No, he's saying it's not applicable.
It's not applicable.
Right.
Doesn't have to comply.
Doesn't have to comply.
He said it's unreasonable for this project.
Right.
The requirement is unreasonable. Okay, so he doesn't say.
It's the language that comes with the Dover Amendment, so it's not that it's an unreasonable request. It's just that's the avenue that it takes to review the process as it relates to a Dover Amendment type project. We still stand by our opinion that, you know, it meets the 10% of the interior.
So just to be clear, he didn't say whether it meets it or doesn't meet it?
No, not address that issue.
So in many ways, this ruling is better than what it could be, and the precedent isn't there. However, if somebody decided to build a nursery school, which is included by the Dover Amendment, then obviously that's unreasonable. And a couple of people have talked to me about whether or not they feel that this ruling is reasonable. The board does have recourse to appeal any ZBA or zoning enforcement interpretations to the Board of Appeals if people felt they wanted to do that. So, I mean, just for particularly new members, when the zoning enforcement officer issues a ruling like this, or the building inspector does that, the Board of Appeals, just like a lot of our site plan reviews, get appealed to the Board of Appeals. That's the attitude or the approach. But you'd have to feel, I think we as a board have to feel pretty strongly about this as to whether we'd want to obtain such a thing.
My take on it is I'm okay with it. I just wanted to know whether it was meeting it or not, and we didn't get that answer, but I'm fine with that.
Right. I'm not sure that our previous ones that we've done since this bylaw has been amended, we probably interpret this as not meeting those. I think Elaine would have. Elaine was fairly strong that this did not meet the requirement.
Thank you.
Chair?
Yes, go ahead, Cliff.
On the loop, as I see, is there enough room for vehicles to go by the buses?
The last bus there, this slide it shows 12, there's room for a 13th bus as well, although they only need 12. But at that point below that is where you would turn into the parking lot.
I think he's talking about the width of the road
the
itself.
The width of the road itself.
Can cars get by?
So it's a 24-foot line. It's a 24-foot wide.
So it's wide enough.
Yeah, plenty wide.
I mean, obviously, at the turns themselves, they encroach over a little because of the length of a bus.
Thank you.
One of the bullets was bus parking. There's technically no bus parking as part of this school, but we did show you the queue length at this point here.
Okay. So let's start crossing off some of these. Let's start with this bus parking queue, which is item 4 on E4. Are people happy with or satisfied with that parking?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Number of parking spots. Can you refresh us on how we determined the 63 and whatever the other number was?
I believe it was a random number. There wasn't what you could fit in, I thought. What you thought reasonable for that type of school?
Yeah, they tried to fit as many as they could in the back lot for the teachers. 63 is what fit there.
Is that an increase from 75? Are there 11 more spaces now? It was 76 before? And now it's 86?
Increased to 86. The reason for that for 86 is because we have a certain amount of space for the parents to queue up around the ring around the area.
Yeah.
And then the remaining parents can park inside and wait for their children. That's the numbers.
So
we figure out the numbers.
So how do,
I'm going to, okay, yeah. I need clarification, because originally it was 70, I thought it was 75, but you say 76 spaces, and then there was queuing around.
Right.
Are you saying that that's the same, or are there now 86 internal lined spaces?
There's 86 parking spaces within the...
So you've increased it by 10,
no,
inside.
Dave, if I could have David answer that, because he did lay out the parking lot.
Yeah, okay.
So we have, we've had 86 spaces in there since our original submission to the planning board, and 63 spaces.
Is it the same area?
And yeah, 86 was on the plan sent to you as in June.
Oh, in June, okay.
So
63. The traffic report might be precede that. Traffic report is on.
Okay, because I was going off the numbers off the traffic report.
Yes. You and Necker speaking off the track report. David and I are speaking off the plans. It was sent around for review.
Okay.
So
that is where we shifted parking from the back lot to the front lot to absorb the teachers. It didn't fit once we did the curvilinear turn of the buses around the loop. So the report for the traffic predates the drawings.
Okay.
Okay.
Report was done
a year ago.
So.
And the zoning requires one space for every teacher. There's 73 in the program. So 63 will park in the back lot, and the remaining teachers will park in the front lot.
Will they be marked for teachers parking only?
I think that makes perfect sense. That would be up to the school committee, I think, to see how they want to designate the parking.
Now, for those teachers, does that include additional staff, like secretaries and...
Yes.
That's all baked in, okay, custodial staff.
So it's just, to be clear, guys, 149 total, 86 and... 40, or 86 and
no, there are eight parking spaces that are alongside the angle parking. If you can go back to the bus loop, you can also see
on the left side.
Yeah, on the left side where we have the accessible parking and a couple of spots.
So like 157 or something like that?
157.
Okay, thank you.
Should there be a sign that says something like staff parking only Monday through Friday while school's in session or something like that?
Certainly the rear lot will be, and we'll work with the school about which 10 spaces or so in the front lot will be designated to the club.
Okay, are there
rear
any
lot is dedicated.
Are there any compact spaces, or are they all full-size spots?
None are designated as compact spaces at this time.
So they all meet the full
SUVs, right?
Well,
just saying.
Have those or not?
Another question also.
Three plus a van, four, there's two in the front, there's six.
Didn't we reach six?
Six.
Yeah. Mr. Chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
So when we talk about staff parking, are we also including, I'm assuming that includes all cafeteria staff, but what about grounds and maintenance when they come to work at the site, and also safety officer, I'm sure he'll be visiting the site as well and need to park there. Do those staff spaces incorporate all of those vehicles as well?
Safety officer would be a visitor based on the infrequency of, you know, when they're there.
So if a safety officer is there and a parent is coming to pick up and all those other spaces are taken up by parents, then what happens?
Officers park where they please and, you know,
park on the sidewalk.
We typically have a designated parking spot for
grounds and maintenance. So that's incorporated in that 63.
Some of the staff are in the front lot too.
Right.
I just want to, my whole goal is to make sure that there's enough spaces for all the parents when it comes to pickup time, that those spaces for the parents are not being taken up by staff, because you're going to have, you know, 80 parents coming to pick up their kids.
I think that another way to put it is our understanding that there will be no spillover parking on Hayden Rowe Street.
Correct.
You know, I think some signs that talk about staff parking, maybe some no parking signs on Hayden Rowe Street, at least on the school side there. I'm sure some of the parents are going to find their way into EMC Park, because that might be the more convenient way to get their kids in and out. But on the other hand, if you're at EMC Park, you don't have the school or the safety crossing guard to get in and out of there.
Mr. Chair, could I just ask a question about what you were saying about the calculation for, was it three for every faculty member?
One.
One?
One space for every
faculty
member. Okay, then you said there were 75?
73.
So you have roughly two for twice as much parking.
No.
I'm just trying to understand what you're saying.
For parents.
No, for in general. What were you saying?
Your your zoning requires one space for every staff person.
Okay.
And there are 73 staff.
Right.
So 73 staff spaces.
Okay.
So we meet the absolute requirements of zoning
right.
comfortably. We've done that on some other things recently, and the needs were a little bit different. So that's maybe why we're getting some of those questions.
So just to be clear, Mr. Chairman, so by design, you're already 10 spaces short?
No, 10 are parking in
moving
the front.
Moving to the front.
But on the staff parking, you're already 10 short on that one?
No.
No.
They moved to the front.
They moved to the front.
So they're going to be designated 10 designated staff parking space in the front?
Correct.
Yes. Out of the 80, right?
Right, out of the 86.
Out of the 86.
Right, leaving 76
available for parents. Okay. We may want to consider the plans with these additional signs is kind of an item. Maybe a condition that talks about parking at major school events where, similar to the notice we did with the library, where when the notice goes out for pajama day or open house day or whatever it is when it's crowded and you can't park anywhere near downtown because the center school, then a notice says that additional parking is available at EMC Park and the high school. Because we on those days we also do not want Hayden Rowe Street parked up.
We have to keep in mind, Chair, that EMC Park is governed by sports, and the sports have no parking. And people are parking on the access road.
I think most of us understand that, but the EMC Park to me is the parking is a shared town asset per se. Most of the time,
yeah.
Little League is not going to happen during when these are going to be at nighttime events.
Very
kids are off at school type of thing, and EMC uses the high school parking lot. EMC will use this parking lot during the weekends. Everything is,
sure.
I think it's cool.
Sure. And I just wanted to bring that up to me.
But I think we want to insist that we have like no parking signs on Hayden Road to make sure that people don't,
Mr. Chair.
Maybe a couple of no parking signs on the drive inward too.
Yes, people will. It's,
right.
It's like gravity and water. They'll
right.
find a place to park. The other thing would be cognizant of Chamberlain. People aren't going to want to walk up to the high school. They're going to want to. They'll find their way over to Chamberlain because that's shorter. It's a shorter walk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They do it now, right?
Yes.
So it's just something to be cognizant of.
Okay. And maybe Fran, you could kind of suggest whether we want to do something on Chamberlain.
I think, Mr. Chairman, when we have our goals also as well about the not parking on sidewalks, I think we should just talk about parking in general, even over like a solid line running along a street.
Okay, so let me try to check some things off. The required 10% landscaping, at this
yeah.
point we're going to check that one off?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Parking lot flow and signage.
I think we're good.
Okay.
John, you good with that?
Parking at major school events, meaning some condition requiring the notice to be included.
You did put that in with right?
Yeah.
I gave you.
She's Jennifer's keeping those tracked.
Okay.
We're comfortable with the number of parking spots meets the requirement, and now let's try to close out parking with the lot configuration. If I remember correctly, there was some discussion, and I can't remember whether it was David or Fran or somebody was talking about how do you get the parent parking lot. Do we need more aisleway or walkway or something like that? When all these kids come out, parents go pick them up, and then is there,
right.
do you need some way to get to the interior lot that would be safer? And that, I think, was the discussion item.
It was, right. So
I think
Cliff and
yeah.
I, we brought that up yesterday, going down.
So let's discuss that at this point.
He's got.
Would you like me to explain
sure.
how that works?
That'd be great.
So this is a one-way loop around here. Cars would be coming in, turning left into here.
Can you
parents
from the other side?
I'm sorry. Yeah.
TV.
You're now left-handed.
So vehicles can either enter here or into here to find a parking space. And if there are no parking spaces when they enter here, they can come back out on the driveway and re-enter to find another parking space that might be open. We have this walkway. that comes all the way across. So anybody who parks on this side can walk safely up to the sidewalk over here. Anybody who parks in the northern half of the parking lot can walk directly to the sidewalk. And then we have this designated crossing area here to prevent anybody from parking on that spot right there, you know, dropping off. They can either pull beyond it or stop in front of it. So this is a safe and open, accessible pathway to the front of the building.
I think I was comfortable with all parts of your presentation except for the spot that's when you said if you drive in this way, you could drive counter to the flow on the other side.
Well, these are two-way access aisles. So this is the only one-way restriction around the loop here. If somebody were coming through here, they could go with the flow of traffic and re-enter the parking lot here to find a parking space.
Okay.
When they leave, they'll leave out this way. Of course, they could drive all the way around, but they'll, I'm sure, leave out that way.
It's kind of similar, too.
You have no right turn lanes on, I'll say, the right side of the parking lot exit. If you're coming from that bottom row,
yes.
To your right.
And now we are.
Right above the 10-foot, right, if you're coming right there.
No right turn there, yeah.
That's a no right turn?
Correct.
Or right above it.
Correct, yeah, you really shouldn't be driving.
Shouldn't be.
You shouldn't be, but if you see an open parking spot and you're late for something, I'm just telling you, you're going to go around and you're going to do it.
And people walking.
Well, if people...
It's going to have a big arrow with one way on it. I mean
you can put the signs, it's up to the police to enforce the signs.
Right.
And, you know, if that gets to be a significant problem, I'm sure... We'll write some tickets.
I would say, through the chair, it's very similar to the front parking lot for the middle school, and it seems to work out okay for the middle school, if you've ever had a late drop-off.
Okay.
In my personal opinion, I don't think we should go too crazy with the standing up signs. I mean, we have
that. We're going to paint those arrows.
Yeah, they're going
to
be huge.
Not to be the most effective. People tend to follow what's beneath them more than the little teeny, you know, 3-inch by 3-inch sign.
Let's take an action and have Beta look at the signage on this. I think you're aware of what we're trying to do. We're trying to make sure that we marshal people in the right direction. And if you can look at that along with the
Is there a question, Chair?
Yeah.
Is there a question between people being able to take a right and exit out of each end?
It's a one way all around, so there's no question.
Yeah, but I'm talking about once they're in the parking spot itself.
Yes, they can go either way.
People can go either way.
That's what he said.
Yes.
Has there been a study of anybody like trying to get out of their car and walk out, and another two cars are going back and forth?
It's a standard parking
lot. Yeah, it's a standard parking lot. Price chopper.
Okay. All right, so go ahead.
No, go ahead. Finish your
So where the middle parking area is, with two noses of cars butt together, would it behoove anybody to just even maybe imagine that there would be a walkway in the middle of that so that people could walk to the sidewalk that is allotted on the right-hand side there instead of trying to go through people backing up and moving out of parking spots?
Can somebody point to that? I'm not sure what he's talking about.
I think this trip, I think this came up at the last meeting, right?
Yes,
you grabbed my thought.
Yes.
But yes, it's...
So the comment is whether a walkway through here...
Correct.
Yes.
...separating the spaces would be advantageous.
And the reason why I say that is because people will be pulling out of parking spots very quickly, picking up and dropping off. So if there was a walkway between those sets that meet nose to nose, that they could walk down that and get to that access point to cross the walkway and get to the vantage point to get to the school.
If you do that, you also need to put a sidewalk on the bottom strip as well then, for the same reason.
So, Mr. Chair, parking lots are inherently a shared environment for pedestrians and vehicles. And you know, to have to cross one bay of parking to here, we don't believe is a hazardous condition. That adding a sidewalk here, somebody would have to step onto it, most likely would then continue on to the sidewalk. People will typically walk through parking lots.
I would agree, because if the way they put together supermarkets and stuff like that, you'd have a sidewalk going down every single aisle.
Yeah. But we're talking about little kids, though.
Right.
To that point, and this is through the chair.
Yeah.
With little kids, parents are typically going to hold those little kids' hands.
Right, but but the little kids are so small that sometimes they get away from parents.
That's why the parents are big and tall.
I look at it this way, through the chair. This is far superior to the way it is now with Ash Street and eight spaces there.
Sure.
And it's
a major road.
Okay, so I think.
And the trees around it.
I'm sensing that the parking lot configuration is acceptable to the majority members of the board.
Yes,
and also, I think the action is this for the flow and the signage is the area, and that might be striping or what, you know, direct, just to make sure we all agree with that. Okay.
But there, one more point about it, though, is we talked earlier last time. I do agree that this. A green strip in the middle would be preferable, but I was mentioning that Al Rogers, who's here actually, if we, not to belabor the point, but just to be certain, for snow removal, it's easier this way, the way that the design is currently?
It would be much easier this way.
Thank you.
Okay, why don't you go to your next stop. Okay.
So the fire department, fire chief, I believe, written a letter to the board, this was shared at the last meeting. The question was about the connection to EMC Park. This is an 18-foot wide paved access that would have a gate at this point and connections to the existing parking lot here. We have another gate at this end and a fence that fences off the play area. But this is open for regular traffic here up to this gate. Signage at this point say authorized vehicles only, and this is primarily for service access to the back of the building.
Secondary.
Okay. Yes, so this section of the fire lane is really a secondary emergency access. Primary being up the main driveway and around the back.
Comments, John?
Just a clarification. I spoke to Lieutenant Porter, and he thought that the road was fine based on the following assumptions that he was interested in. Is that it was an emergency vehicle entrance. It could also handle a school bus evacuation, school buses going out, and that 18 feet wide was enough. He was going through the calculations of the width of the vehicles, that it was enough that you could get emergency vehicles down and school buses out at the same time. So as long as the 18, I want to see, is the 18 feet wide enough for that? He said, if you can't do it, then what we're going to have to do is put policemen at the bottom and at the top and do it similar to when you have a lane closed on a highway, is release one direction and another direction. But his concern was emergency vehicle entrance in, and be able to put, if there's a blockage at the front entrance, to get the buses out in that direction. And he was calculating the width of the buses versus width of fire trucks and the police department, and thought 18 feet was wide enough. So I just want to confirm that that's what everybody's on the same page.
Yeah. Niche Engineering has run the auto turn movements for both buses and emergency vehicles. And egressing out this way with buses is not a problem.
But can we get both going at the same time? So that's what the concern is.
Can you get our new ladder truck and a bus bus out?
Because if you have a blockage in the front and there's traffic accident, snowstorm, and you've got to evacuate the kids, and you're trying to get the kids out, and you've got emergency vehicles coming in, the same way you have two sets of fire stairs. You want every recommendation that I've read what Connecticut's written in response to Newtown. I've read what has come out of Columbine, is that there should be controlled, shouldn't be a public access, but there should be two means of egress out in case of an emergency, because if one is blocked, you need a way to get the students out, same way getting emergency vehicles in.
So just so I'm clear, is it planned for 18 feet? So the question is 18 feet 20. Enough? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, if it's 18 feet is enough, I'm fine.
My understanding, I don't want to put words in the superintendent's mouth because she's here, but in the event of emergency, there would not be loading children on buses to get them out of there. They would evacuate them on the ground because the buses would not be located at this location. And to wait for buses to arrive, collect children in an orderly fashion and drive out there would be counterproductive to the type of an incident that you're talking about. So no, it's not envisioned to be used in that manner of speaking. It's for fire and emergency responder access.
But it's a, they could go two ways.
Chair, we've had discussions with this planning board member as well as you that the school department has had discussions about every emergency situation you can think of for this property, and that the public nature of this venue doesn't lend itself to discussing details of a response to every situation here. However, those discussions have happened with the police and fire chiefs who provided feedback to your board. Thank you.
I, for one, would be feel a lot more comfortable with 20 feet, given that
what's holding us back?
Right.
I mean,
and just to the point of you saying that there's never a situation where the buses are going out. What if there's an incident while the kids are loading on the bus? You're going to get emergency vehicles in and school buses out.
Under that scenario, it'd need to be a regular width roadway, which is 24 feet. So why stop at 20? So I mean, you know. It's an emergency access road for first responders to get to the building to respond to emergencies. That's the intent of this.
Well, we want our emergency people to.
The new rules for the fire department, if it was a single access to it, requires a minimum of 20 feet. So the fire rules basically say for an access road you need to be 20 feet.
Primary
and
access road.
Primary access.
Well,
quite frankly, at a high value piece like this is, I would like to see two primary axes, basically. I mean, even though one is gated as a secondary, but I wouldn't be skimping on the 2 feet of
I wouldn't go the argument of why not 24. Let's go back to what's the cost involved for adding two more feet to make it 20. Why the resistance?
Through you, Mr. Chair, the cost is not just monetary, but when you put a 20-foot road in, that's signaling to everyone that this is now subdivision, this is roadway standards. This is a secondary emergency egress road. Our primary emergency egress already exceeds 20 feet by quite a bit, Jeff. It's 36.
You, Mr. Chairman, we don't care about what we're signaling. We care about the safety of the kids.
18 feet. We have the fire chief here in case anyone would like to ask his opinion, which he's already provided in writing.
Chief, do you want to speak to this one?
From everything I evaluated from the public safety code, the exception is there, and to evaluate the 18 feet versus 20. 20 is just a standard point to get access, and then they give me a chance to evaluate or make an exception. I looked at the fire protection plan for the site. The building is totally sprinklered. The access around the building is above what the code requires. They provided additional setup room and structure in the back of the building for an aerial device. And as I reviewed that, I said that is satisfies all my needs public safety wise. So that's what made me say the exception is comfortable as far as I'm concerned on the fire side.
And you can get your new ladder truck and a school bus through that tight turn?
I do. I think just on a personal note, similar to like Elmwood School, they have a backup access. You manage that as part of the incident. We have incidents at that school that we've dealt with in the past, and if the primary access is blocked, then we need to work harder at managing the site, and we know that going in. I work with police, and we manage the site and the traffic on the site better. So I don't think that where we are at 18 and 20 feet, we can manage the site fine between those two differences. I don't think it's actually going to make a difference. If we don't manage the site, 20 feet won't work. If there is an incident that's significant, the 20 feet won't work.
If he's okay with it, I'm okay with it. Are you okay with it, John?
I'm not convinced. But let's continue.
Well, let's try to...
Through the chair, and a question for the chief. I think we already discussed this last time, but worst case scenario, you could drive over the edge of the road if there's two trucks coming in and one coming out or whatever. Ambulance is coming in, fire trucks coming in.
It's not going to be any curbs, right?
It all looked manageable to me from my evaluation. I watched the analysis that they did. Again, the primary access is the front entrance, which is got a much wider width, and I can do a lot of management there. Now, there can be a scenario like a wire down across it where you do have total blocking of the entrance, and I'm comfortable that managing the 18 feet, we can take actions.
Thank you.
Good evening, Chelsea Christensen from Edge Engineering. I'm a civil engineer. To answer your question, the vehicles can physically pass one another. Cab buses go out and fire trucks come in. The bus would have to pull over to the side. There's enough pavement there for them to physically pass each other. And there are no curbs, so they could go off onto the grass if they needed to. It would be the shoulder on their side. Maneuver around in an emergency situation without being blocked.
Board members ready to put the 18 versus 20 foot to rest and stay with the 18?
Yes.
Okay, let's cross that in. Oh, before we finish that interconnection is made of pervious surface?
Porous pavement.
Porous pavement.
I have an issue.
Go ahead and ask your question.
I did some research initially when another project came up, and I like the porous material because it allows the water to disperse evenly. But what happens is, over time, silt and everything builds up into that. What is the maintenance aspect to that porous material, and how do we maintain that to keep it from the flow going through that porous material?
Sure. It needs to be vacuumed once annually. It's a rental service. You hire someone to come in, they vacuum it over the course of the roadway to clean it out from the year's worth of dust and silt that will settle on a road.
And does that silt and dust turn to a clay type material that would be almost impossible to get out of that?
I don't know how to answer that in terms of dust turning into clay, but well, my understanding.
Well, silt is very fine. Right? And as water hits it gets more and more packed and to a point where I my mind says that once it's in there, even a high vacuum.
Let me try to ask a question. Somebody from Beta or whatever, how do you maintain this stuff and does it work? And if you maintain it, does it keep doing this porous type stuff? And the other part of that question, if you made it solid, what does that do to your stormwater calculations?
The point I would make before that question gets answered is, does it matter? If it becomes non-porous, we're no worse off.
Well, that's storm drainage, what he just said. It's
no difference than having non-porous.
No,
porous. The storm drainage.
Yes, porridge, the porous one allows.
Okay, the question is,
For beta,
whatever. Did they take advantage of it being porous in the stormwater calculations? Go ahead.
So, porous pavement does need to be backed once a year, about on average. And it never gets back to 100%. You know, it will fill in over time, I should say. You never get 100% of the fines back out of it. But if you think of a normal pavement, it has a lifespan of say 15 years. At the end of that 15 years, probably it's not going to be really porous anymore, but you'd replace the sidewalk in its usual lifespan anyway. So it typically, by the time the porous ability of the pavement is no longer functioning based on maintenance, it's time to replace the sidewalk anyways. It would normally be time to replace a normal sidewalk.
By the time we pay for it, we'll have to buy another one.
If I may?
Yeah.
So the calculations of water runoff is calculated by the porous material, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So if it was a solid sidewalk, your calculations would be thrown way off, right?
To a degree, yeah. I mean.
Right.
Let's try to
quantify this a little bit. You've got a good picture of where the porous sidewalk is right in front of you. Where does that water drain off into? It's a question for one of the civil engineers of the crowd out there. Where do we pick up that water flow?
Well, for the extent of the porous pavement ends right here, right? Throughout here and in the edge of the pavement. Now, for the question about the porosity of it, the way that it's modeled for stormwater management is it is so porous, water goes right down initially.
Right.
As it gets clogged up, you're never going to get to 100% impervious. I mean, you will lose some porosity, but in comparison to regular pavement, it still enters the system much faster than it would with, you know, obviously with regular pavement, it's not going to get it at all. The vacuum sweeping gets it back to, you know, 85% of its capacity over the first 5 years or so. You can also do power washing if you have some problem areas. The most important thing is to make sure you don't have run-on onto it, which is why we have it, you know, graded to the sides to keep the neighboring landscape areas from going onto it. But that also helps it to, you know, if there was a problem, the water would just shut off like it was regular pavement.
Well, wouldn't power washing force it to pack more?
They do it at an angle to shoot it out. It shoots the...
Well, I've seen it. I've seen it. Excuse me. I've seen it in action. I've seen it demonstrated. And if you power wash that, you're going to force that material in there. There's no way of power washing that out.
Okay. I think we're going a little bit too far.
I don't think we got an answer to the question of if it was cut in the calculations or not.
Right. I guess the question would be, if we don't have ports, then with the regular pavement, does our underground detention basins get larger?
It is not connected to the underground detention basin, so it would be a separate system. If I were to model this and say that it's mostly clogged, I would expect the results would still show that it was more pervious than the existing site material, because the glacial till is there.
Yes, but we still have wetland there, right?
No.
If I could explain a little bit from the sidewalk, that where that is kind of like a spine. It comes from the flows from the north to the south and then to the east and the west, and where if there were runoff a problem, it would be coming toward that area where the pink and green is, so that's protecting the building, and it's not so much of a concern, especially over time, the difference in the calculations. It would be interesting to see them mathematically, see the metrics, but
let's just verify that in the stormwater maintenance program that the sweeping of this or vacuuming of it, maintenance of this is in there, or if not, we'll put a special condition on that.
Very good.
And what I'm hearing from the engineer, it sounds like she would be confident, even if that was a solid paved side road, that the drainage would still be fine.
Well, I think the drainage is going off into EMC Park.
We would still deal with it as...
Well, as Beta said, that it changes the demographics completely. If it were solid versus porous.
You didn't use the word completely.
Well, she just said it.
Yes, it does change it, but you're not really getting, because of the way the soils are here, you're not really getting the runoff that you would expect. You think you're putting water into the ground, but it's really very solid material.
Sure.
It's actually giving it a better opportunity to get into the ground.
I agree.
Cliff,
would it be
through the chair? One final question. You've got a hill. The sledding hill is right there that you're kind of moving over. Is that cause of a problem where that obviously is above the sidewalk? Do we have to regrade more of the sledding hill to keep the sidewalk doing what it's supposed to be doing? Or are we just going to get runoff off of, or wash down from this pile of dirt sledding hill onto the sidewalk?
We are scraping away the edge of the sled. We are pushing the sledding hill back slightly on that side closest to the roadway.
And putting in like a swale of some sort on that side? And are you taking it back far enough that you get like a swale to keep? For what I heard the concern was is dirt from the sides getting onto the top of the surface. Mm-hmm.
We'll look at the detail for getting to make sure that works. That's what we're looking for.
I think with that potential condition, we're all set. Let's go to the next item.
Next item is site lighting. And,
I can at least go into the color pitching is needed. So we've done, so this original diagram shows the color rendering of what the photometric plan shows. Again, this is for the 20-foot high poles, which is what we had originally shown. So it's basically gray is basically there's no foot candles, and then it starts with 0.1 to 0.5 and this light blue and goes all the way down to green where we're 3.1 and moving over. So basically what you're seeing in the 20-foot high poles is basically a direct kind of purple spot almost directly underneath each of the sight lights. But the main parking areas are covered, but they're not intensely covered. The next slide is when we go to the 15-foot high poles, and I think it added, Joe, 11 lights altogether?
Six poles and fixtures, because the adding fixtures.
You added some double fixtures to this. So what that does is, as you can see, it does generally increase the overall lighting on the plan, so there's a significant amount of purple, particularly in the parking areas where these were mostly in the lighter blue in the previous renderings are now primarily in the purple range. Do we have averages for what the 2 foot candles were for the 20 and the 15?
We do. We broke it down into three spaces. The west parking, the 20-foot poles is an average of 1.5 foot candles. With the 15-foot poles, it's 2.31 foot candles. It's a higher average, but the uniformity ratios, of course, for the 20-foot poles are lower versus the 15-foot. The average, the minimum is 5 for the 20 versus 7.7 for the 15-foot poles. And the maximum, the minimum is 14 for the 20 versus 17 for the 15, so which reflects the intensity of light. More so on the poles,
right?
On 15 foot, which is natural, which is more concentrated light. And similar for the north parking, 1.53 average for the 20 foot poles versus 2.75 for the 15 foot poles. But the average to minimum is 3.83. With a 20 versus 9.17, so it's quite a bit of difference on the uniformity, and just similar results with the right way.
Does this meet the average standards that's in the lighting code?
I haven't looked because I haven't seen this. I haven't seen the 15-foot pole.
We have not seen the 15-foot pole data?
Did you send that to me?
We
sent it
black
and white.
Yeah. Correct.
Is that part of that FTP?
Yeah.
Okay. I guess the action item is for our consultant to look at the average. We have a standard, I believe, that's in the bylaw as mm-hmm. far as average. And you board members have never heard me say this, but is this overlit?
The benefit is you can have like a roller hockey in the upper
I guess I'm just not clear of the process here. We have a 15-foot restriction, right?
Yeah.
So we're asking them to go to 15 feet.
Yeah.
Well, no, last meeting we had, Ken had suggested that we could show some levity on the 20-foot. And
let me rephrase. Yep. Our bylaw was recently changed to 15-foot parking
okay.
laws. However, this board has the authority under special permit, which they do not want to go through because it takes additional time.
Correct.
You can go to higher levels if it's so deemed.
Correct.
And gets approval. And so we're really looking at 15 foot.
Okay.
But and without Claire being on the board, this would be the question that Claire would ask every time. Is it overlit? And, you know, it, I don't know, you know.
With the LED lighting, of course, the entire school is LED interior and exterior. You can dim the LED lights. So the automated lighting control system, of course, can dim these lights by circuit.
Okay, so this is at its, I'll say, maximum light output as opposed to what you could dim it down to 50% of that
this
or whatever.
This is full bright.
And you've included in your spec the dim type system for that, or is this part of the switchgear or whatever you call it for lights?
It's included. It's the all lights are provided with dimmable drivers and the automated lighting control system in the
Okay, Mr. Chair, and
that's the same for the 20-foot poles as well.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
We're not talking about 20 feet. That's not their proposal. Well,
no, but we
my
should.
My concern is with a dimmed light. Does that change the zero levels on the outer edges? And I just would like to know if it is dimmed, which maybe it will end up being dimmed. How dark does that make those outer level those outer edges? You know, are we now under, is that going to underlight? If this is overlighting, is there a point where it could be underlit?
Well, the plan is full brightness. I'm just saying you have the ability, if there is one area that you would like to dim on, for whatever reason, you have the ability to do so by group on the poles, by surfing.
Is there a schedule, and this is an action item, maybe not for tonight, a schedule of when you turn the lights on and off for this
those
type of thing?
Yeah.
And are there the different zones that, you know, maybe you would have a, say, a basketball team using the gym and you keep the staff parking lot open and, you know, the driveway lights kind of
dim
going
down.
And
right.
you
right.
don't light up the front parking lot, you know.
I think Al can answer that question for the facility director.
Right now we typically have lights come on at dusk and they stay on all night.
Okay.
The good news.
Chair, I just want to offer too that speaking of lights, the fact that the management system is in place, I think, is something this board should take very seriously, because the district has, even as recently as last year, when a new light was installed on this building, we got complaints from a neighbor and did work to actually manage the lighting. I forget whether it was a change in angle or something on that light to alleviate the neighbor's problem. So we will have the management system in place to be able to work with any of the impacts. So that's what I think our engineer was saying, that we can even control it by zone. And the school district has a pretty good history of working with neighbors to make sure we don't want the lighting to be shining into neighbors', you know, houses. So I think the fact that we're taking those steps to those controls, we may not have all the exact answers, but we will manage it and we'll obviously work with the surrounding community to make sure it's as effective as it can be without being too disruptive.
Quick question. So is this the only school buildings that have the configurable lighting?
No.
Is this the only one that has that configurable light? I'm good to go with yes, beer here,
be
so.
Yes.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine another one did. Yeah, this would
okay.
be the only one that has that.
Thanks.
All right. And the good news, Al, is you'll have an app for this. You can do it right from your home. You can be able to do. I was only saying half jokingly. So you would be able to manage this.
Okay. Well, only thing I'd like to point out is the homes that are yet to be built to the exact right of the staff loop driveway, the back of the house, the way the wetlands and everything sits right where that arrow is staying, will be less than 50 feet from the lot line. So,
but those are zero. There are zero lights at that level.
Yeah. There are zero lights at that level. There's
and Mr. Chair, I think that's a great example of those zones, right? And when we would actually need those lights. I mean, that's an area that presumably would be used for the occasional evening event, but in the normal course, I mean, that's the bus loop. So
right.
that's used mostly during the day.
And
so I think that in the future, obviously, those houses will be built knowing that that lot's going to be there, which is obviously different than the current abutters. But but again, great opportunity for the school district to work with those abutters when that comes up.
Can I ask a question, please?
Yes.
Chair? Would the secondary road be lit up as well under the parameters that we're setting on lighting?
There's currently no lighting on EMC Park, we're not introducing fixtures onto their property. If they wanted conduits, we could put a conduit under the road.
There's one emergency light at the doghouse, which is the snack shack, and that's it.
Okay.
EMC Park was approved by this board for field lighting.
under some very strict guidance.
We're going to try to finish up with lighting, or we're going to try to get
Yeah, we're going to try to finish up with lighting, for sure.
Can I just ask one quick question, Mr. Graziano?
Yep. Go ahead.
All the schools are currently lit all night long. They come on at dusk is what, or maybe it was Mr. Rogers who said it.
Yes.
They all come on, every school, they come on at dusk, they stay on until dawn.
Yes. Minimal lighting or full?
Actually, at Elmwood, there's photo cells. Everywhere else, there's time. While the building, center school, there's photo cells.
Okay. So it would be no different than this school or the high school or currently center school?
So is that minimum lighting, Al? Or is that full lighting?
They don't have, we didn't have the technology.
A lot of the technology being used here has come up last couple of years.
Sure, sure.
Okay, I'm good. Yes, sir.
Hey, so again, Dave DeStefano, from directly across the street. I just have a concern about having that light on all night at the end of the driveway.
At the end of the road, you're right.
Right, it's right, I mean, we got pictures of my house if you want to put them up. It's great, my bedroom windows. So I don't know if we can have an 11 o'clock cutoff or, right, like I understand security and I understand safety and all those things, but I also understand.
At least right there at the end of the driveway.
Right.
Is there a street light on the Chamberlain corner?
There's a street light on the pole.
At the exit.
I think we accept the condition to dim that. John, I mean, it's your first opportunity to.
Well, again, I just want to go on record.
Condition to maybe turn some of the lights on at
shade or
at a reasonable time.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
great.
Jen, you got that?
Yep.
So, we'll work on that. Anything else on lighting?
Just some about security building lights. Or?
Well, I think. I think it goes without saying that they'll have lighting on every entrance because
right.
That's what the code requires. And it sounds like their security is to keep a lot of lights on. Hopefully with this condition, they can turn a bunch more off when it's reasonable to do so at night. I mean, you need to be able to make sure that kids aren't vandalizing it or older kids are not vandalizing it, but I'm not sure you need all that lighting on it.
Just so
and the action item, I guess, on lighting is still to look at that average that's in our standards because we don't have that. We don't have that answer. So lighting is.
Yeah. As far as we know, we think it meets all the standards.
We're going to go subject to confirmation that it meets our standards. We're all set.
But the pole height's good.
Pole height is all set.
So
let's take pole heights out of there. Security building lights. And we'll leave parking lot open based on and driveway open based on making sure that they meet the average standard. That's to make sure there isn't, I think it's the ratio of hot spots to dark spots, if I remember the standard
right.
Correctly. Okay, we've got we got four more minutes.
We can move on.
Let's move on to one more if we can. You've got, I think, trails coming up.
The Army Jack. Yeah, let's do the trails. So the action item at the last meeting was to go back and look at what we could leave open to make sure we don't preclude anything in terms of the trail. So we looked at two layouts on the graphic behind you. The first trail was what was kind of described to us in the meeting, which was to try and wedge it in. If you look at the far most right spot on the slide, you'll see there's a dark black area between the blue and the red and gems. That's a drainage outlet area there. So that was kind of a restricting factor. So our first look was to see if could we fit it between that edge of work and our bus roadway. And so the area in red actually cut into our slope, kind of put a 3-foot retaining wall in order to get the 12-foot pad that Eric had asked us to look at. That comes with a hefty price tag that would be, in the six figures range in order to do those retaining walls on a 12-foot pad. I'm sure certainly more than they'd be looking to spend on that roadway. So after meeting with and discussing with Ken earlier in the week, he notified us that a trail use is exempt from a setback. And so that leaves Eric a lot more flexibility in where a trail could go.
So what the blue trail does is the blue trail shows between the lower part is the 25-foot dashed line on the inside corner of the blue, and the outside is the property line. So if Eric was to propose a 12-foot wide swath that hugged the 25-foot setback, that would provide a 13-foot buffer between those future properties that Ken has alluded to. At the bottom right corner, because of the topography that butts, that drops to almost nil, a little lower left. Right there, at that pinch point there. It gets a lot narrower, you're probably down to like 5 feet. But again, if a trail use isn't allowed use to be within that zone, they could do it. Their cost would be clearing the trees and then leveling the dirt in that area. That's beyond our limit of work area, so we will not be working in that. If you recall, we're not working in a 25 to 0 foot range. So that would be left in its natural state today and would not preclude them from doing a trail at a future date.
Are any of that blue, purple path, whatever, in wetlands?
Yeah.
No.
It's in the buffer.
It's in the setback, but it's not in a wetlands buffer. It's in a setback.
It's in the 100-foot setback?
This is the property line here, and this is the 25-foot zone. Yeah. So it's hugging the 25-foot zone as it comes around the property. There are no wetlands in this zone here. Anything in blue is not in a wet area.
Okay, that was the question.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I can, so that trail will enter to the emergency road?
Yeah, well then on the right side, the reason it's feathering up, it's merging back up to the level that the service driveway is on and then could connect up to EMC Park.
So
and at the lower level, it merges back onto the entrance to the school and could go to the other side of the parcel.
So what does the orange indicate on the lower right corner of the loop? If you could show me on that with your cursor.
Where are you talking, down here?
Nope, back up, right there. Down lower, right there. What's that thing, what spacing is that?
So that was where they overlap. So the toe of the hill is right here. So we were trying to look at where there was room between the 25 foot, he could swing out not have to encroach into the hillside, so that's why those overlap at that particular point.
Okay,
just the two options.
Oh, I see. Okay, now I can see the darker orange.
Yeah, it's a layer.
All right, yeah, all right. Yeah, so, okay. So that would allow
he would
the trail
the blue,
to.
Yeah, the blue would follow this zone here where it looks like there's a third color.
Okay, all right.
It's just the overlap.
All right,
the red.
All right, because I thought it got so thin there that.
No,
that,
no
all right.
Still the 12 feet, it's just the overlap.
Question through the chair?
Yep, go ahead.
This is also to Eric and Jane. If the red path isn't cut in and made perfectly flat and there is an incline, would that be an acceptable trail or would it be too steep?
I think the steepness you're worried about side to side.
Yeah.
They would have to shore up the thing with a retaining wall in the center.
Get very
now we're talking over $100,000 that they don't have and we don't have.
But what if we did over the top?
Well, that's where the blue is then, or the purple.
Look at it from this standpoint. The further away from the bus road that we can get,
the better we like it.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
We want it for privacy, protection for the students as much as anything.
I was just looking for the synchronicity of two things in one.
Landscape
property,
the people on the trail will never know there's a school there.
Right.
Excellent.
And we just want to be allowed to have the space there at some future date.
And to your original question and what Ken was saying, you just want the trail to be flat this way, side to side. You don't want it slanted like that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's
and
what
he's asking. There's tree buffer in between there, Eric?
A lot of it's going to go away.
A lot of it's going to go away, but when we do the trail,
yep.
Then we have a clean slate to do whatever we want.
Okay.
We can put up fencing or whatever.
You know,
whatever
we'll make it
nice maple trees.
Floral, yeah. As it can be. The only issue I have, and I don't think it's going to end up that way, is I want adequate buffer between the trail and the properties to make it develop.
Right.
So 17 feet is fine or whatever it is. Or if I had to come to the school and say,
eight feet wide,
a couple more feet here and save something over there, we could probably work on that.
Eric, 30-foot maples are in your budget, right? You can handle that?
Okay, so I talked to Peter Mezzo. We need to come to a conclusion to try to end this.
So what, if I may ask this last question, please. The width of the of your trail is what?
12 feet.
And at some point, if you feel that you have enough buffer, or you don't have enough buffer, you can narrow that 12 foot down, right?
Well,
we can't. The 12 foot is what the Milford Trail is, and that's what we're trying to reach.
I see.
Let's conclude this tonight with there is the possibility to sneak the trail in around the park.
That's great.
Lot.
Thank you.
That's great.
I think that's our goal. And, you know, it might not be the cheapest section of your trail, but, you know.
Well, it was going to be cheap.
Yep. Okay, so basically, we'll check off the trail location at this point.
I'm going to give a last update. So I just want to, you know, an important one is we met with the abutters today. Mm-hmm. So both Mr. DeStefano and the other two abutters that are directly adjacent to the mouth of the driveway, we talked about some mitigating factors and the timing of that. What we concluded is that the town is going to work with those abutters in terms of whether it's a fence or shrubbery. But the important thing for them is to really understand what it's going to look like. And so we've agreed that, you know, once we clear the land, we should re-meet again and determine what are the final details of what they're looking to accomplish.
Let's talk about that more at our next meeting, and let's also try to write down what a condition would mean to maybe implement it that way, one way or another. I mean, we're usually into let's plant a row of trees here or whatever and relook at it or something, but we can structure a condition that would satisfy the school folks and the abutters. So but I entertain a motion to continue the public hearing until the
22nd?
The 22nd, and Jen, what time?
We have 7:30, we have the master plan special permit amendment for the 180 units at Legacy.
Okay, let's do it at 8 o'clock.
Before that, could you just, I don't see trails on the outline, is it on the
up two, yes. Yeah, number two.
C2. Okay, thank you.
It's up there, C2.
Mr. Chair,
oh, yep, got it, thank you.
What? Yes, can we?
You want to go back to town hall?
I really, really want to go back.
Except for, can we fit this number of folks in?
Can we get the big room?
I mean, hopefully, can we request a longer meeting at the next meeting? We should be able to get done in one. We got more than an hour.
We'll see where that is, depending on what happens with the rest of the schedule. You're getting over half our meeting time as it is. Okay.
It's up to you wherever you want to be. It's just a lot easier for me if it's a town hall.
We'll make that determination.
Well, we can't. We have to do a date and time certain right now.
Oh, really?
So.
Then let's go do it here.
Okay.
I'd rather have.
Sorry, Jim.
Appreciate it.
Assuming that Kathy, you're okay. Okay. So the motion is to move to 8 o'clock on the 22nd here.
So moved?
8 o'clock.
Yep.
Second.
A point of discussion, Mr. Chairman. Yeah. Are we hoping to get through all of the rest of this at the next meeting? Because, Joe, I wanted just to go back to, are we in line with what your timeline expectations are, meeting all the way through?
I'll let Jeff speak to it.
So in order to stay on track for our project, we need to get through the remainder of the items at the next meeting. We're scheduled to go out to bid that Wednesday with our finished product in terms of site bidding to get started. Our intended start date is the end of September. So in order to stay on schedule for a school opening in fall of 2018.
I just remind the applicant that we will not approve site plan unless we have all the drawings up to date. And we will do very few conditions that says you'll change this line to this line. We want the electronic version of it as we're under ZBA requirement for site plan requirement to do that. So you're going to have to, if you come up with some drawings and you got two options and you think we might be going one way or the other, have them both prepared for that next meeting, because otherwise you won't make that date.
I believe you have all updated drawings based on everything we're aware of today outside of future comments that will be given to us at the next meeting.
Okay, well, I'm work with Beta in the meantime, please. There's a motion on the table to
seconded.
And seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. This is a continued public hearing for the North East, Northwest, and North Club Villages at Legacy Farms. This is the site plan for Poulton Homes, 125 housing units.
Hey, thanks for putting up with me.
Not a problem. It's all for the good of cause.
I know.
They're all good comments. I mean, the intersection is better than, this is all part of the course.
Absolutely. So thanks for working with us. You're doing a good job.
Thank you.
Appreciate
you.
Okay, let's get going.
Well, we have our names, but sometimes we love the roles to the line. It's a little bit clearer here because we're separate.
Jennifer is not too happy about it.
Really?
Maybe the center school or a new model will be meeting space.
We've opened. Let's get going here.
Yes.
Okay, Mark, why don't I suggest that we start with kind of an update of what's happened over the last couple of weeks, and then maybe we get into the construction management plan?
Yep. Sounds great, Ken. Board members. John, do you want to?
Yep. Since we met last, a few things have happened. We were just at the Conservation Commission hearing, at which we received approval from the Conservation Commission. This project, we've done a lot of work to keep everything out of the resource areas to the extent that we can. We've got a very limited amount of work in the resource areas, so I think they were very, very happy with that. So we just left the commission, and they voted to issue a notice of intent.
Order of conditions.
Order of conditions from our notice of intent. We have also submitted the construction management plan previously to this board. I don't think we didn't get a chance to discuss it last meeting, but again, that was a culmination of meetings with Beta, meetings in town hall with staff and Ken. A lot of work went into that. It's essentially a 20-page document, not counting the exhibits. To put it in perspective, the south side, I think, was a page or two. So it's a very, very detailed document that talks about how we're going to construct the project. That has been fully reviewed by Beta as well, your consultants, and there are no outstanding comments on their end on that document. And finally, we received Beta's peer review comment, and it was a very, very good comment letter. There were no technical deficiencies. The stormwater was all good. They did have a couple of suggestions, which what we could incorporate, we did, and resubmitted those plans to you, very, very minor changes. What we couldn't, we told you why we could not or why we didn't think it was appropriate to do so.
We'll go through those in detail after construction.
Yep.
Okay.
So that's where we've been since the last time we were before you.
Okay. I propose for construction management that we take out the latest document. I think it's dated August 1st. And the only way I know how to do it, it's a bound folder.
Yep.
The only way I know how to do that is to start with page one and just work our way on through. And maybe some of the pages will go pretty quickly. A lot of my comments have already been in. I still have some writing on the pages. But I really want to hear from other board members on this whole thing. So, starting off on page one,
think the notable thing on that is there's signatures from everyone up and down the stream that basically acknowledge that we have a construction management plan that Pulte's going to actually follow,
first
I think,
one.
On this, this side
very
of the
first
project.
One.
So I'm comfortable with page one. Any comments from the other members?
Is this standard practice, or is this a best practice to have?
Probably best practice, I would imagine.
Some towns do construction management plans on every project. We didn't have much on the south side. We did a few conditions, but a lot of this was, in my opinion, due to the execution on the south side that the district board answer the question.
And we appreciate all that you've done to make this viable.
Okay.
So thank you.
Good. Let's try to get through this as quickly as we can so we can make some real progress tonight. Page two, I had one question. It says project is subject to and adhere to the EPA construction general permit and a full stormwater pollution plan will be prepared prior to construction. Who approves both of those plans? Are those EPA signs off on those?
Yeah, so the EPA construction general permit, it's a general permit that's issued essentially to everybody. You have certain criteria you need to meet, and you submit what's called an NOI, not to be confused with a conservation NOI, but you have to submit an NOI to the EPA, essentially certifying that you are meeting what's outlined within their document. So it's an EPA, it's a federal document.
How is that enforced?
The EPA can enforce it. If there's an issue, the building inspector can deal with it. But it's a federal regulation.
But the EPA doesn't come out and inspect what you've done?
They don't have the resources to go to every site that has
It looks like it's a very general permit. Jennifer just gave me one.
Yep.
That's one that they gave me.
Yep.
What?
That's what they've given me. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's when I asked for it. That's what I got.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the permit.
So
it's 158 pages with the appendices.
We'll just pass this right along. I mean, it's...
I'll read it real quick. Hang on one second.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Everybody just hold
so
on.
So that's basically EPA, based on a general document, they gave you the permit, and then they don't watch it. I think that's what I heard.
Right,
yeah.
That's what I heard too.
Okay.
Well, but the stormwater pollution prevention plan is monitored by the Conservation Commission.
Oh, get it clear.
Yeah.
Okay. And so the stormwater basically gets approved by the Conservation, and you got that approval?
Correct.
As part of what you did tonight?
Correct. Yep. And your peer
and they're following your plans that you had laid out, right?
Okay.
They're going
okay,
by.
Let's keep going.
I just need to ask this question, sir. You submitted a plan, and they approved it.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and the plans are the same plan. As we made revisions for you, we went back to the commission. So everybody's on the same plan set. There's not two different plan sets for one for planning, one for CONCOM. It's the exact same plan, exact same drainage report.
If I may, through the chair,
yep.
Former CONCOM member, I would like to. I'm their liaison. I don't meet with them enough. I would like to see more of a formal process where you guys were approved and we get notification from Don McAdam to vote.
I actually did get a text during the meeting from
Excellent.
Anna Rogers that they did get an approval. So
Excellent.
I don't know how formal that is, but
yeah, we're only there an hour ago.
It's better than me having lunch with those
guys.
All right, thank you.
Okay. So I think we're on page three.
Yes.
Any questions, comments?
Page three.
Seeing none, page four, I have a couple.
I especially like the sequencing because it can explain to the neighbors what's happening next. Not that they're the audience for this, but it helps.
The question four.
Page four.
We debated back and forth when we were meeting in the top paragraph. How many acres of land should be allowed to be disturbed or open at any time? And at the end of the day, the best I could do was 55
acres, but this is 55 out of 90 acres that's going to be constructed up there.
112.
But some of that's...
Well, so that's 50% of the, of the land usage.
That still seems, I don't know, high to me, because it almost makes this document kind of partly meaningless, but maybe it doesn't if we do some other things.
One thing, it is a lot of pre-disturbed land, farmland.
Yeah, but we were worried a lot, I think, on dirt and dust and blowing around like the south side was,
yep.
When they just, you know, opened up everything all at once and then closed it up as they finished putting the last siding on the outside of the houses. You know, you didn't see any stabilization in between that time. You still don't see it on the south side.
Yeah, and we did add very specific sections having to do with erosion controls and stabilization and timing, understanding that's really what the concern was. So there are sections in here that that do talk about that in much greater detail.
So while we're going through that, let's think about this 55 acres and see where we should go. Coming out. Down on the bottom of that page, there's a paragraph that says, throughout the duration of construction, provide stormwater management or control and treatment, provide temporary stabilization for areas of disposed in accordance with this, with the CGP and the construction management plan. And I would suggest we eliminate all non-active, and quite frankly, the non-active stockpiles will be stabilized monthly. Even if it's active, it should be stabilized on a monthly basis to keep it from blowing around. So I would take the word non-active out of that. All disturbed areas will be reviewed by the town by the end of each September 15th, so that, because this is a 12-year plan, and provide temporary stabilization measures will be implemented by December 1st, the following December 1st.
Not the 15th?
No. I mean, you're trying, and then there ought to be a requirement for self-certification of the amount of open area.
So that goes back to the 55 acres?
Yep.
And that last change, was that page 9 or was that earlier?
Page 4.
Because on page 9 it has the same kind of wording.
So does Pulte have any suggestion on any of that that Ken just...
Yeah, I mean, you know, at this point, you know, we've made a really concerted effort to really create a workable construction management plan that addressed all of the concerns and comments of the board and concerns from the south. Stabilizing active stockpiles is atypical, I would say, in normal construction.
The problem
business.
I have with the discussion is you won't have a non-active stockpile anywhere on that site. That's what's been your practice. Everything, you'll take a loader and you'll take one bucket out of it every month and you'll say it's not active, not applicable. So it's a waste of the paper that you're doing. That's your practices to date. And you're living with your practices on the south side. And that's where we're coming from, because we don't want to live with the practices on the south side.
Right. Yeah, so...
So do you want to permit, you're going to, in my opinion, if you want my vote, you're going to do it right this time around. Because we've learned that when we don't specify it, you don't do it right.
So we would like your vote, and we would like the permit, and I think, you know, the changes that are going forth right now, you know, we're okay with.
Okay. Actually, we can take, because my partner, known as 9, is the monthly owner certifications can be prepared.
On page
9, that they'll take care of that, so we don't have to do that on that page.
So Ken,
yep.
Following you, page 9, you say there's something there that
yep.
Okay. Can I get to that, please?
Well, let's keep going. Page 5, did anyone have any questions on?
Well, I'd like to revert back to what you said, Ken, now that you've taken a breath. And that is we're talking about changing the non-active stockpiles. We're in agreement with that through poultry, right?
Yeah.
And now that also goes back to the question of the 55 acres.
We have not set aside, we haven't finalized the 55 acres.
Right. So where that has been posed already, can we make some sort of address to that?
We will get through the rest of it, then we'll come back to 55.
Okay.
So that it's in context of the entire plan.
That okay?
Because
right? That's okay.
Page 5.
Go ahead. Yep. I think is where we first come across the first of many questions about this, and it's the word shall. Plantings in established areas shall be completed per landscaping plans. Earth disturbing activities shall be kept to the minimum. Is there a difference between shall and will?
Mr. Chairman, if I can answer that. We do a lot of legal documents. Shall is a much stronger legal term than will.
Okay. Perfect.
That's yeah. Good.
We do construction specifications that you want to say shall, not will.
Okay.
Because it has more, as of course, more.
Can that be defined for me?
We don't need to debate who it is tonight.
Yeah.
I don't know the legalese of why it's stronger, but.
Okay.
Thou shalt not kill, I guess, is part
right.
of
it. Right, yeah, well, I guess that one really sets a precedent.
Okay.
So I had one question, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
On the preliminary construction schedule, looks like you're going to have A1, A2, and B going at the same time for a period of time.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
That falls within the 55 acres. Doesn't
correct.
Kind of. You know,
yeah, we outlined in the construction sequence on page 3 exactly how that was going to happen, and that's really what this duration is derived from. When you have essentially a nine-year process is laid out in the construction schedule.
Again, just going back to Ken's statement about the 55 acres, I agree with him on that being a massive amount of open space to be used all at once. So, I guess we'll go back to that. But,
yeah.
Okay.
We're looking for you open it up, you finish it, then you open up some more, and kind of roll right through the process. And keep, and you understand that you've got to move some dirt around, etc. But you know, there's only so many houses. You know, a good year, if you're going to sell 80 houses, which I think is a pretty good year,
mm-hmm.
That's 20 acres, I think, roughly. There's about 4 or 5 of these per acre.
Would we say 126 acres?
It's about 112 acres.
112, I'm sorry. Yeah, 112.
And a lot of this is open space type stuff that you can go in, get it stabilized, and be done with it. Okay. What page are we on? 5, 6?
Still on 5, but if you want to move to 6, I don't see anything.
Okay. Questions on 6? 7? A lot of this is coming from other federal requirements, I believe.
That's correct.
8? Page 9? Page 10.
Well, on 9 is that wording, so if it would be stronger, taking out the non-active stockpiles, because they're all active?
do we have non-active?
Stockpile soil paragraph?
Yeah, that is in there as well, yeah.
Where is that? Do you see?
Yeah.
A monthly owner certificate? No, not that one.
Monthly owner certifications
yeah.
will be prepared,
yeah.
can be provided upon a request, stating that the
non-active stockpiles. So
just
throughout
the active. Take to the word non-active out. Yes, good catch, Frank.
So
that
throughout this, I guess we've kind of made the precedent that non-active is not the verbiage that we want to be seeing.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay.
On page 9, Mr. Chairman, yep. under dust and wind controls, it mentions in the middle there, if field observations indicate additional protection is required. What triggers that? Is that an abutter, or is that somebody from the town? How is that process?
I mean, ideally it would be the construction folks that are up out on site. So, I mean, a perfect example is, you know, if you're watering regularly and things are under control. However, if you get a very dry summer, you don't have any natural rain, you might need added protection that you may not need the previous year. You may not have needed the previous year just because circumstances changed. So that's why you put that in there, just to, it's a little bit of a living, moving document. It doesn't lock you into just doing this no matter what. If circumstances change that you have to do something more, that's why we say we're gonna do something more to alleviate the potential situation.
And I think to answer the question from a town standpoint, the building inspector is the hammer.
He's the one that kind of.
And on the south side, just for perspective, a lot of people on Curtis Road had the problems they would call up.
And I think that's what's triggered my thought here a little bit, yeah. Right?
So well, then can we change the wording from should be implemented to shall be implemented?
Yep. We can do that.
Okay.
Part of it is when you kind of open it up and you leave all the foundations the way they seem to kind of bulldoze the whole area, it's very hard to get a water truck through all that area. Anyway. Okay.
It's a very good point.
We're on page 10.
To the chair.
Yep.
Material storage and effort should be made to store only enough product required to do the job. Are we talking about the entire job, or are we talking about 55 acre, or what's, that's kind of.
It's vague.
Yeah.
Page down 10, the bottom, materials storage, and storage,
first on
page
10.
Essentially, I think it's that language comes directly from the construction general permit. But I mean, I think the intent is to only have what you're going to need. You know, for instance, you're not going to buy the lumber for all 425 units and keep it out on site. You're going to store, you know, what you need for what you're building in the near future. So it isn't something that's generally, you know, quantifiably, you know, defined, but I think the intent is for what you're actually going to be using in the near future.
This one, I think they have a self regulating,
yes.
Meaning they don't want to capitalize anything more than they need to at a time. So this one I don't have a problem. And the stockpiles of dirt is a little bit different, but
okay.
This one doesn't bother me as much.
Well, how many, may I ask through the chair, how many foundations do you open up at once?
Well, right now we're doing about 6 or 7 homes a month.
Okay,
so and those homes are started 6 or 7 homes a month, and they're all in various stages of construction until they're completed, which is about a 4-month process. So, you know, there could be 6-7 times, you know, 4 is 28. There could be, you know, 30 to 40 foundations or homes in various stages of construction.
Okay,
right,
so
now.
If my calculations are right, then. Do you start the subflooring of the structure after the foundation is in? Do you backfill the foundation then, or do you wait until construction has been started and everything else has gone up?
You backfill before the subfloor is usually.
You're backfilling. You're taking your soil piles, and you're alleviating them before you start the construction of the flooring and all that other stuff. Is that correct or no?
Well, Cliff, the interesting part of their construction that we didn't anticipate on the south side is they'll bulldoze a trench for a whole line of houses on one side of the street. And then,
because
they're only 20 feet away.
Right.
So they take all the soil out,
yep.
Stockpile it, do whatever,
yep.
And then put the foundations in,
yep.
Because they're sitting on basement floors is kind of what you're seeing.
Yep.
And then they'll fill in around the foundations as they put them in.
Okay, so you see what he's saying? I think I'm reading into this maybe just a little bit right, is that with that much
dispersion of topsoil and everything, you're creating a dust storm anyway, right? So my question was originally was, how many are you doing at one time? And he just elaborated, and you're agreeing with that you do a scrape of the foundation areas that you're going to do. You set up your forms, you pour your foundations, you cure, pull the foundation forms, and then you backfill.
Yeah, that sounds accurate to me. The homes are, as Ken mentioned, in a cluster development of this, like this type, it's not feasible to go in and dig out each individual foundation that are 15, 20 feet away from each other. You dig them all out at once, and then
So this is where the management of dust and everything else comes into play, because that's a huge undertaking, and if you've already got areas that are developed and you're moving that much earth all at that time, you're creating a big amount of disturbance. Correct, maybe? Yeah.
I mean,
I would add to that comment, larger than just multiple homes being multiply dug, it's greater because it's all the space in between them as well.
Right. So right. How do we mitigate making that the less?
That's what this construction management plan is trying to do. So. Okay.
That's right.
Page 10.
There's a lot of controls in here.
Okay.
Page 10. Page 11, and this is all from the federal stuff, which I guess if we knew it was all from the federal stuff, if we were smarter, we would sit Curtis Road on them before. Page 12. 13.
13, I just have a question. And I forget where we left off on the whole scope of things. I think it was a historical question for Roy more. Back when I was on the Green Committee and project was coming up, and we were talking about possibly getting some land to do a community CSA farmland, and we were told that there are herbicides in the ground over time, it makes it really too not such a good place for planting. And we're talking about the top near the gas company. And then I thought the rest of the property would be, is it going to be treated as you go along for herbicides and pesticides that have been used for the past 50 years?
Those have all been cleaned up, correct?
Yeah, I don't know which
country. I'm just trying to get the scope of things. So now the new herbicides, pesticides, fertilizers fall under this rule in a construction plan, and I'm just trying to see if everything's connecting in the right way. So
this is what basically the federal government requires as a standard. That part's been
it's a standard guideline.
That answer your question?
And that's why
yes,
I'm not spending
you.
As much time on some of those pages, because this is lifted from another document.
Sure.
14, similar. But if you've got questions, go for it.
I have one question. It's more of a general question.
Yep.
So this seems all well and good, but to the extent that this information is disseminated throughout the work site, and the guys that are actually doing the work and the managers that are overseeing them, how does that actually get done? Because for you and I to read this looks great. Does it go on a shelf and get dusty?
No, our impression of this document and the reason that we put so much time and effort into it, and it's so carefully worded, is that this document will be is part of hopefully an approval that the board will issue, and it will be treated as any of the record plans and documents and permits, and it'll be disseminated to all the contractors that work for Pulte. Ultimately, Pulte is the owner of record, and anybody working on the site, you know, they report to Pulte Homes. And they have to answer to us, and it's up to us to manage to all of the requirements and permits and approvals of the project, and this would be one of them. So
I would think you have the project manager
will
be very intimate with this and be monitoring all areas of the project.
I believe the federal stormwater, you have a
weekly meeting or something that talks about
it? We have weekly meetings, and this document will be made part of it.
So who do you report to on our end as to see if we're comfortable with that?
Yeah, on page one, we had added in here that the building enforcement officer is the enforcement, has the enforcement authority to enforce this program, so.
Director of Municipal Inspection.
I assume there's some type of checklist that he's using.
Infrastructure, Chuck works for Elaine, and Elaine manages the land planning.
Okay.
We all work for Elaine.
Well, she works for us, hardly.
Okay, 15?
Yep.
16?
Yep.
17? 17, we have a little bit, Fifth Street, it's delivery and trucking. Fifth Street shall only be used by light vehicles instead of as needed. I think that's what we agreed to. I mean, all your heavy construction is gonna come off of Legacy.
Yeah, I think we discussed that.
And particularly Fifth Street, who was concerned with the butters that, you know, that is Roy's private road. We do not want it beat up any more than it is. Because the Mezzets are very concerned. Mm-hmm. Okay, so just light vehicles on 17, 18.
Does that have to be a change? I didn't, delivery trucking,
yeah,
blah, blah, blah.
That Fifth Street was minimal.
Fifth Street will be only used by light vehicles.
Light vehicles. Thank you. Flipping up.
Yeah, we had written that it specifically prohibited heavy equipment from you.
Yep.
But we can add light vehicles for sure.
Would that be a counterintuitive on that?
Yeah. It's not heavy, it's like holds and suspenders, I think.
Yep.
I mean, you know, if the guys going up to there want to drive their pickup truck up there, you don't have too much of a problem with that. But,
right.
But when you
flat set of trusses,
bring in heavy duty.
Well,
lumber
trucks are accessible, right?
Lumber trucks will go off the other part of the site.
Yeah.
Not up that street.
Okay.
Because
right.
There's no road connection by the time lumber trucks are there.
Okay.
It's mainly for heavy-duty construction stuff.
So
this will not take it for very long. Okay,
one quick question, because it's on here again. Is should the same as shall?
Say it.
Is should the same as shall?
Should the same as shall.
You said shall holds more weight than will.
Shall is actually a legal term.
Yeah.
Should is something you should do. You should take a shower now and then, but you shall stop a stop sign.
So where are you going with this?
Well, just, you know, I've seen it a few times, you know, like here on page 18, contractors should follow manufacturer's recommendations for proper use. You know, and I've seen on previous pages should, and I was just curious if that carried the same weight as shall, or?
How about we change should to will?
Or shall?
I think, to be honest, we're dancing on the head of the
okay.
Head.
Yeah, I do too.
I think what's more important in this document than the actual language is the following the intent of the document. That is the most important thing.
I agree.
I think this, just to let the board know, this is the most comprehensive construction management plan for a residential project I've ever seen. So I think you've done a great job. I think the most important thing is going to be, as Mark said, making sure it gets into the right hands. Because this could be the greatest document in the world. No one is aware of it or follows it. It's meaningless.
My point.
So
right.
I think the reality
is it's got to be in the people's
hands, the building inspector's hands, and somehow I think that the chairman of the planning was going to keep an eye on it. So I'm not worried about it being implemented.
Yes.
But it's important that the crews who are working the area as well.
It's part of their onboarding training.
Let's go to page 19.
Before we go, Ken, just back to you again, is that to be that upset or know that what happened, what we had to learn from, this is all predicated from that. So why not, that's why the magnification on the wording. So it's not to try to put you guys under the microscope, it's to say this is what we've got. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, page 19, I think we're all set.
Yep.
We have an index which has got a lot of kind of interesting sequencing exhibit. We've got the cuts and fills, the earthwork exhibits. And let's see, I think, did we add something, the last page, which is, talks about restricted land, kind of put it together there. You might notice that we also had a requirement in here to segregate the natural state and the restored restricted land, I believe, of the two. That basically gets
signed in again.
Identified early in the process so that they do not get fully stripped and ripped up.
Excellent.
And this is on the last page, Ken?
That's the last exhibit, but that goes to the word in that. So I think we're down to Auburn. Two letters, or two numerals. And I'll take comments from members of the board on page 4 of 55 acres, the right amount.
Mr. Chairman, before I get comments from the board, could I just take a few moments and just
quantify,
present the
sure.
reason that we came up with the numbers? I think that
yep.
would be helpful.
Okay.
And I don't know if you have the big board, but I know we all have the 11 by 17. Do you have the board?
I think you're looking for the instruction sequence of documents.
Yeah, I do, yeah.
That everyone's
that
got in front of them.
So if everybody has this in front of them, I can try to, you know, I don't want to take up too much time, but.
What pages?
No, this one.
This
first
is
one.
Overall sequence.
First.
I'll start until he gets the board.
Okay.
The board, John? Yep, I've got it. Let's just get the board. So I just want to take a moment here. So we understand that limiting the open areas is an important topic. And as John mentioned, in the construction management plan, there are tons of different areas of protection to the town about really the goal of limiting open areas. And it's the stabilization of open areas, it's the protection against erosion, protection against dust, and all stabilization techniques. So I think they all go together, and it's all the intent. Roy mentioned the intent of the document, and I think we're all on the same page there. But the reason we came up with 55 is, one, is that we need to make sure we can build the project successfully and efficiently so that we're not moving material once. And so what we came up with is we would be starting and building sequence A1, and then at some point, as we mentioned, we would be moving.
Come over this side, there's something you're blocking a couple of people.
It's okay.
Just stand
I'm
going to
stand
side.
Right here. Okay, thank you. And then we will move to sequence A2. What we mentioned in the construction management plan is that construction sequence A2 has excessive material.
Right.
Due to the topography of the site, it just there's excess material here that needs to be moved. And due to the material, sequence B, and due to the grading here, needs material in order to balance the site. So what we've proposed is this haul road that we've all discussed, that's very clear in the construction management plan,
yes.
that keeps the construction traffic off of Legacy Farms Road North, which is a really important aspect of the plan. So what we've proposed is when we're opening up sequence A2, is that instead of moving the material, opening up the area and making these big stockpiles, either here or moving the material and making stockpiles here, the goal would really be to move the material once. So in that case, what happens is when you move the material from A2 to sequence B, we're building this road here, which needs a lot of material, and moving this material here, and this is still open. So the 55 acres is a calculation of a third of sequence A1, because that's, we think, we'll still be building A1 when we're starting A2. So it's a third of A1, all of A2, and all of B. And that's a worst case scenario. The intent is not to be butting up against 55 acres the whole time. That's the reason for the calculation. It's
spread out over the
spread out over those. We're the worst case scenario when we're still building here. We just opened up here. We have all this material that we need to move here, and we're going to move it here to build this road. And then when this road is built in this area, and we're still working up here, you know, we'll temporarily stabilize down here, and the number will go down. And as we complete this, the number will go down. And I think that's a worst case scenario. But you know, that's we didn't just create a big number. That's the reasoning. And the goal is to, we need to be efficient. I mean, the goal is to move material once. If you're moving material more than once, it costs a lot of money.
All right.
And the goal, and there's 425 homes here at 60 or 70 homes a year, which is our projection. I mean, we need to be efficiently moving through the site and having roads open ahead of time so that we can build in a continuous building. Any other restrictions that really prohibit that method, it's just going to cause, it causes delays. And so I just wanted to explain that to the board before you comment.
I think, in my opinion, if the number is smaller, it's going to cause you to create non-open areas. Basically, you're going to have to cover it. If you lumen seed something, it goes off the equation. And that's what we're trying to say is we don't want a dust bowl of, I think, 55 acres at one time. I mean, you get to the point where I understand you got to move from one spot to another, but, you know, once you trench out the homes and you throw on some stabilization, that comes out of the calculation. That's the point. And according to the federal guidelines, you're supposed to have been doing that on a weekly basis, which you haven't done on the south side. So, I mean, you're not meeting the federal guidelines, and I don't see where 55 acres is reasonable for the people on the side of the board, but I'm not sure what the reasonable number is.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
All right, so I have a little bit of knowledge in building, and I understand the usage of the 55 acres, and it's not really using 55 acres. It's transportation of the soil to the other site. So, but if you were looking for clarification, 55 acres is probably needed because of the transportation of that material. So,
to that point, can I ask a question?
Sure.
To the chair, how many acres are included in a calculation of the 55 when you're including the haul road? Is that the haul road is part of the calculation?
Yes.
No.
It's not.
No, it's not.
Oh, see, now that's where my calculation in my mind changes.
Right.
I thought you were using that as part of that equation. And so what would happen is you need that acreage in order to transport to that other spot.
Well, the haul road's a given, and quite frankly, they could run the water truck down that on a daily basis and probably...
It's a small amount of area.
Right. It's.
I mean, the 55 isn't a magic number. That's the way it was calculated.
Sure.
The 55 we can live with, and we know. And if the haul road is 3/4 of an acre or is an acre, then when we're certifying it and we're making sure that we're under the threshold, we would that would be included.
All right. So what? Go ahead, Roy.
Ken. What if there was a limit to the time it could be a full 55 acres? Because you could be coming into the winter, coming into the spring. What if there were a time limit that you couldn't hit the maximum of 55 for more than 6 months? And then it had to be reduced from that, no longer than a 6 month period. So you're not worried about a constant 55 acres being opened up.
Well, I guess the problem I have with the 55 acres is I don't think you can do dust control on 55 acres. There's not enough water truck passage if you were trying to treat it.
So I guess where I'm going to come from on this is I think the 55 is difficult to quantify, because if you're following your construction management plan as it stands, probably, as he's described, half of that 55 should be already stabilized. So is that technically open anyways? If there, and I think if you follow your daily or weekly or monthly procedures, you're going to be stabilizing as you go. And you shouldn't ever come close to the 55.
Should, but on the south side, that's where we're seeing reality and we're trying to plan.
I think the issue is enforcing it on a monthly basis, that, you know, stockpiles should be stabilized after 30 days and open areas, you know, nothing open for more than, if you hit the enforcement of this and make sure that, you know, you've opened up this building site, the foundations were backfilled, that you put temporary seed down so you're not just have a dust bowl.
Yeah, that's right. I see a little disconnect between the two parties. Like, if you look at, what is it, C, that you're building up the road?
B.
No, no.
Oh.
A, oh, sorry, B. Yeah, it is B. Sorry.
Yes.
That you're building it up. Like, Ken's thinking that you're going to be looming and seeding and not all that being open at one point. So, I mean, I think that's where...
Well, I think the definition of what is open, because if they're actively working on 55 acres... that may be okay, but even if they're actively working on 55, for a large portion of that should be stabilized.
Right, and that's where I was trying to go with this. My initial question was this, is that if you're bringing soil and you're putting it in, once it's there, you're not going to be there working on that aspect of that, right? You're going to fill that road, mm-hmm. and you're going to go back to construction and on A and B,
mm-hmm.
right?
Or A2 and A1.
A2 and A1.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mostly.
So a lot of that material, there's a time window, just like Roy says, that you can get that done and get that over there.
Mm-hmm.
So the wording, maybe we can retract some of that, or let's even go even one step further. And 55 acres, to Ken's point, is a huge amount. That's half of the project. So why don't we find a medium somewhere where maybe we go to 45 acres at an open space time,
mm-hmm.
and then that's a little bit more manageable for under what Ken's trying to say, and then also we. You know, we're kind of meeting in the middle here.
I still think there's a disconnect. Like when you're working on Area B, Ken's thinking that some of that can be put back out of that 55, and I'm not hearing like
it can be.
Like
once
why
we
wouldn't
build the road? We would temporarily
right.
stabilize.
So why would you need that
back?
Whole area open?
Because
the whole
when
pen?
We open it, it's open.
It's open.
You open it at once, and then you can start to put it back. But it's. I don't want to get caught that I have a document that you can't open the amount of land that you need to actually grab the material and put it over here. Which you can't just.
You're
limited on how many dump trucks you're going to get across the haul road on a daily or weekly basis. I mean, you only have to open ahead of what you're going to be able to fill in the next week or two. I mean,
all it's doing is asking you to keep track of. How much you're closing, right? If you want to open more, then you close something, right?
Yep.
Mr. Chairman,
you can control it yourself.
I think when you look at the overall plan and not individual pieces, when you look at the stabilization of soils, seeding in certain areas, dust control, I mean, those are your real issues. It's dust control, erosion control, stabilization, and seeding in areas that have been disturbed over a certain period of time. I think the burden is really more on Pulte to try and minimize the amount of acres from their own perspective. I don't care if it's 45 or 55 or 105, whatever the number is, because the reality is the higher the number, the more difficult it is for them to meet the criteria. So it seems to me that they're self-motivated to minimize the amount of disturbed area and still meet the guidelines.
Yes, but
let's why don't we sleep on this one. We are getting really close to the hour. There's one other thing I want to try to take up tonight with Pulte One, and let's just cogitate of, you know, the 55, I don't the way it's written here, maybe that might be the right one. Roy might have some ideas.
Can we agree on a number? I mean, Cliff suggested 45. I mean, can we agree on 45 or 48 or some number?
I want to hear from the rest of the board members.
If I can, I truly think that even if we worded it at, and they went down to 45, and we worded it to allow them, go ahead. To allow them to have a window of timeline, like Roy says, to get that done. I think that would be the extent of that much acreage being used.
Cliff, I think you're to interrupt. I think you've gone too deep for this point tonight. I think to Ken's point, we don't want to make any decisions now until this detail. Let's not try to rush it in 2 minutes. We can't come up with a number, right?
If we were to rush it, it'd be 25.
Part of it is I remember this almost same conversation on the south side, and we ended up not putting any number in. And most of you guys,
but we are now, so Ken.
I understand, but I mean, we had that same conversation X number of years ago when we got to kind of this point.
And you even alluded to something saying that it's even right now still a problem over on the south side.
It is.
So I mean,
they don't follow the federal guidelines. Whoever's got that thick report.
I got it right here in front of me.
On the south side. I mean, it's, but.
So you want to table this without, yeah. I mean, we're this close.
We're this close on construction management plan. Let's take an action item, all of us, maybe rewrite that entire paragraph to makes more sense and take the number out or take the number, you know, figure out maybe another way to kind of describe that it's a, maybe the words that says that after every week you're going to close stuff up is enough. I don't know. Or maybe you define what temporary is better, or non-active or whatever, to get, and, you know, let's just take some more thought on that one.
Well, we have some other edits to make, right, that you mentioned tonight?
Yep, we got a few more.
We're proposing something for next meeting.
Okay. We're pretty much at the witching hour.
What was the item you wanted to bring up?
Well, I was going to go through the where we are on this
outline.
You know, the beta letter.
Yeah.
Let's take 5 minutes to do that. You know, the school might not get some mad at us. My wife's out of town, so big deal. We've got
part of your house tonight.
Yep. Coordinate future planting of Legacy North with a new gravel parking. Okay, I assume that one was no problem. It's obviously, we're putting gravel in there. We've got a few changes with trees around.
Correct.
Adding a decorative fence around biome retention at Road G.
Yep. Point that out real quick. That's no problem. We agreed with that. That was just right in this area up here.
Okay, so that's what, to keep people out of it, or?
I think it was more decorative.
Okay.
Just to clarify, the roadside only.
Correct.
Not
yep.
Totally.
Correct. Yep, and that we specified that in the response and on the resubmitted plans.
Okay, the response, I'm not sure did.
Yeah, you guys got the, you should have got the fuller response in your package.
Did I?
Yeah, it's in the.
I found it.
Yeah.
I found it.
Okay.
No, I didn't find it.
Okay. I don't. I thought I had seen it.
Look on the front page.
Okay. P3, which is adding stone walls.
Yeah, I think they're attached. If you,
what?
I think it's attached to what you're reading.
On the back.
It's like all one package.
Okay. The P3 adder, stone walls, or other amenity that fits the neighborhood to the ends of new boulevards on Road F.
It's right in here.
Were you looking at P3, did you say?
P3, yes.
And that is kind of a cosmetic type thing?
Bottom first.
Yes.
That? Very bottom.
And that was okay?
Yep. We added that in the plans that we resubmitted to you.
Okay. So that's all set. North Club Village. That's trees again.
Same comment.
The Hammerhead, I understand that can't be flipped because the mezzets don't want it. So that's okay.
I had seen that in the email, but it was
This is.
Okay.
It's not a copy.
And you're looking at P5, Ken?
I'm looking at P6 at this point.
P6, okay.
P5.
That's, I assume, okay?
Yep.
Did that?
Okay. And then we get into the C1, grass hammerhead. Was that grass, or is this one of these structured pavement or whatever?
That was a broken pavement, wasn't it, from what I remember?
It's grass pavers.
Grass pavers, as opposed to...
It looks like grass, but it's structured.
Twenty loading, it's plastic, it withholds the weight, and grass grows through it, so it's because it's near the homes.
Acceptable to fire department, DPW. DPW could care less, I would imagine, because they're not going to deal with it.
There's nothing underneath there that has to be dug or anything else like that, right?
Nope.
Okay.
Parallel parking, eliminated additional parking at the trailhead.
We decided to get rid of that.
Yeah, we all talked collectively about that one.
And we did some adjustment on that too, correct?
Correct.
All right.
Okay. Transformer pads.
Yeah, we put them where they frankly fit on the site. At the end of the day, the electric company will dictate where those will go as well. So we put them really in the only area that fit, but we're somewhat at the mercy of the electric company.
Is there any landscaping at all around those, or are you stuck with not?
They don't like landscaping.
I have a Verizon across the street from my house that they put into a wood thicket, and that, I mean, it's hardly noticeable.
These are Eversource.
Yeah, yeah. So, but
and the drainage swale C4.
That's actually not really a drainage swale. We just we provided contours showing that the water would drain to a, you know, not puddle. So we had contours, and they commented that it was a swale kind of going through the, by the back decks. It's not a swale. It was a very small drainage area. It's not going to be conveying any water. Okay. We just graded it so that it would go to a low point.
It's graded to the drain. It's not going to collect a lot of water.
Okay. You're okay with that?
A lot of water. Mosquitoes are the biggest issue.
No, there won't be standing water.
Okay.
Yes, there are standing water.
Board members, we have some time available next Monday. Next Monday, we're doing peer review proposals till 9 o'clock. And if you want to, and this would be at the other building.
Is that a two hour for peer review?
7 to 9 o'clock meeting, right?
7 o'clock. We have half an hour interviews for three finalists, and then half an hour to discuss it, make the decision. And then, so at 9 o'clock, we expect to be open. I would propose that we go from 9 to 10 next Monday
for this?
And continue on this. So I propose a motion to continue this public hearing until 9 o'clock on
the 15th.
On the 15th.
Are they okay with going so soon?
So moved.
Second. Second. Further discussion.
I will not be able to be there, and I would like to ask the board not to pursue this because I've been working on it for so long. But I thought we were planning on the 22nd for this.
Have you missed one meeting yet?
I haven't missed any.
Okay, so you're all set. The probability of us getting through everything else we have to do in 1 hour. We're getting closer, but we haven't gone through each of the villages yet. So I think we're pretty.
And also, isn't the interview process Monday and Tuesday?
No, just Monday.
Isn't it? I thought the latest email, just correct me, just to fill me in. Yeah. I thought one of the companies were traveling, they couldn't get there on
that was going to be tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
And then we canceled that day altogether. And now all three of them are on next Monday.
Next Monday is going to be over back at Town Hall, correct?
That's
correct. And for homework for the board members, spend a lot of time looking at the proposed draft approval. And, you know, it is truly draft at this point.
If
you can suggest it, yes, it was in your packet today.
This one.
So are we meeting next week on this item, or are we not? Because
well, we are about to take a vote on whether we are. So there's a motion in front of us, I believe, for 9 o'clock on the 15th at Town Hall. Probably 2:11.
Definitely
2:11. Clarify this for me. I've got two drafts here for minutes.
No, those are minutes.
You've got this one here?
That one there.
Okay.
One.
So what is that, Ken? Can you just explain?
It is a decision of site plan review.
Okay.
A lot of times for the new members, most of the time we draft those decisions after we finalize everything.
Okay.
To make it a lot easier on the bigger project, we've kind of gone ahead with the draft on this.
This is the culmination.
This is kind of the culmination of the whole bit.
Sorry.
And at the end of the day, that's kind of what they get. They get to proceed.
Yep. Understood.
So a lot of times your chairman ends up blessing whatever Elaine or Jennifer kind of put together after it's at. But we'll probably do one of these for the school, start one of these for the school, too, because on these bigger decisions, it makes it a lot easier. So, but this is our thoughts of, or Jen's and Elaine's and Roy's and other folks' thoughts of what it should look like, and it's also based on what we did on the south side. That isn't to say it shouldn't have some other things to it or other conditions that might be needed too.
Can I just ask Jen an administrative question?
Sure.
The electronic copies, you don't send attached files though, right? Can you send me?
No, you do get, the agenda has everything attached to it.
Just click on the agenda.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Okay. Let me just respond to your statement, Ken. If this was meeting was happening, a regularly scheduled meeting, and I was traveling, I couldn't make it.
Yeah.
That's my argument. Is that you want to change for this presentation to have it happen next week at a time where I cannot meet, and okay. that's my objection. Okay. Is we're changing it for a developer. And
well, I guess because we had that other meeting scheduled, we have another hour. We've been working at this for a long time. I know Mr. McDowell is anxiously waiting to make this sale of land. And I guess, yes, we have an hour then, which would then allow us to maybe spend more time with the school. You know, if we're getting that closer, and you know, we've got pressure to get school approved, and certainly Mr. McDowell, I'm sure, is more than
and Frank,
interested
we,
in getting this thing done.
We appreciate
we
your.
Talk, we could just talk about the villages we next could, week, right? And kind of close we, everything up, and then.
Well, the construction aspect of it is I think what needs to be, and I understand what you're saying.
I can catch up on what I miss, but. Like if I'm not here to vote.
No, right. That's what I'm saying.
I don't think we're going to vote next Monday.
I'm not sure in another hour, Frank, that we're going to get there.
Why can't we just say we won't vote next week because he's not going to be here?
Okay.
Thank you.
But maybe we'll get to the point where we can vote in a very short amount of time the next time around.
Right. Just bring it up and
which is only a week.
And I'll definitely catch up. I'm a big fan
this
of our show.
Never want to. To make prejudged statements about what's going to happen at your next meeting, I would just make that.
What do you say that again, Jen?
I would just caution the board to make prejudged statements about what's going to happen at your next meeting. You have no idea what's going to happen.
We didn't say what was going to happen. We said what was going to not happen.
Well, that's what I mean.
Because somebody's not here, though.
But I'm just.
Yeah. No, I know what you're saying, but I'm just.
Right.
We have a motion on the floor.
You heard what she said, right?
Motion on the floor. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain?
Nay.
Motion carries. Okay, a couple other things. We'll talk about sidewalk parking in another meeting. Letter to the Board of Selectmen. Review and execute documents and plans for Haynes Farm.
Yep, I have all that here. It's all been reviewed and approved by Town Council. He had no page actions to execute.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for your time.
Documents this evening.
Thank you.
Guys on TV.
When are we going to see your smile?
So.
I have a comment about the letter. It's excellently written. I appreciate that you wrote that.
Which one?
The letter to the selectman.
Talk about that the next. Okay, we got your comments, but I want to get out of here at a reasonable time. We need to get the
Thank you.
Haynes Farm going.
So this is the
revision at 25 Ash Street. Those of you that don't remember, these are the plans that were approved, the official plans. The selectmen approved the street name, Hayden's Way.
Okay.
That was added to the plan.
So let's just put them out on the table. And I'll entertain a motion to sign the plans. I believe we need at least 5 signatures.
That's correct. And then we also have the conditional approval agreement and covenant that needs to be signed.
Can we accept a little bit of discussion on this?
Yes.
So can somebody kind of summarize? I remember, I think, attending a meeting. I'm not even sure if it was a member. It was not a member. So
you can still sign
there's
it.
Some. This is right off Ash Street, right? And there were some concerns with the neighbors next door?
It was the
abutter. We've got that all taken care of.
Okay.
This is just codifying what
all
we approved
approved
earlier.
Okay.
It's all been approved.
So everybody's happy?
So this kind of
generally speaking
takes the what we agreed to during subdivision. This puts it on paper.
Okay.
This also allows them to proceed. They've already cleared the lot.
They cleared it, yeah.
And Jen?
Yes.
Did we put something like riprap on the entrance or something like that as part of the stormwater thing? Because it's just dirt going right
out
of
the
street.
I don't know. I'll double check. We also have Luckner Bias as the inspector out there, so I can have him take a look.
It's not to the point where it's a mess, but it's
pretty close.
But if it got wet, if they started doing vehicles in and out, it would be.
Yes, it would be.
So you're looking for a stone construction entrance?
Yep. Okay, I entertain a motion to sign the plans and
so moved.
And the documents.
Second.
And you, they're all to form.
They are all to form.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Need 5 signatures?
I mean, more is fine, but
yeah, we're getting the last thing. We'll take care of minutes next time,
okay?
Because we want to get out of here. We had correspondence from the Todaro folks, and as you remember, we gave them the historic exemption with a historic covenant. Town Council has looked at that since we approved it. And Jen has looked at that. The selectmen are about to sign a slightly modified one. It protects the town a little bit better. It isn't exactly what we voted on, but it meets all of our intents. It's been agreed to by the lawyers and the historic commission.
Yes.
So I just wanted everyone to be aware that if you were seeing one versus what you saw before, that you would not. Like I initially did, is what the hell is happening? You know?
I have all the changes here if anybody wants to look at them. I mean, they're just mostly like what the town remedies are legally, or if they don't record it, the Historic Commission has the option to record it. Town Council wants to have Mass Historic to sign off on it. So there's things like that. They're just more things that I had originally put in there in the first place that got removed are now back in. So. There you go.
Could that be something we can see electronically?
Okay.
Or
okay.
Do
so
I can send it to you.
Thank you.
With that, I think we've done a lot of hard work tonight. I appreciate you staying the extra 15 minutes for a motion to adjourn.
Before we do, since I won't be here in the next meeting, I have read the minutes of the last 2 meetings that we're talking about, and they're. But we'll talk later.
Okay. Thank you.
Motion to return.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 I used to ask, is Frank the only one not coming next Monday?
Okay. I'm in.
And I will be traveling at that time, otherwise I dial in or something.
Had I missed one of these meetings that for
yes.
This?
Yes, but you signed a certification.
Yeah, that I watched the...
I gave you that link.
Yeah. No, but what I was... This is for